in your head. Online.com. That's the important stuff. Now, the most important thing is you listen to Jake the Snake Roberts. Don't you ever forget that, or you just never know what might show up.
All right, and we're back. And we're joined by one of the legends in the NWA, probably the most famous referee, I would say. We've got Tommy Young on the line. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing great, and I appreciate what you said. I can't add anything to it, and if you got any more to say, throw it in there.
Now, when we announced you're going to be on the show, and, you know, I said this when I was a kid. I hate saying that when I was a kid, and I don't want to make you feel old, but I remember watching you flying around the ring, and it was something that, like, really struck my interest, like probably the first referee that really caught my eye. What did you think, like, that added to the match?
Well, you know, I always had a flair for the dramatic. My whole family does. I come from a very dramatic, animated type of family. And, you know, I broke in as a wrestler first. And one night we didn't have the referee, and I started doing it. And nobody ever trained me. And I knew what to do. I knew the basic premise of what the profession of wrestling was all about. And I remember a number of wrestlers coming up to me telling me that, you know, you're kind of unusual, and what you do really helps, and you ought to stay with repping. We really need good reps. And I thought about that, and I knew I wasn't going to make it as a wrestler. I wasn't bad enough. I wasn't good enough. I didn't have what it took, and I had difficulty with my hearing, which was also tough. So I did more and more repping, and I always felt that the referee needs to try to help the wrestlers as much as he can. And when young referees come up to me, and most of them are very nice and want to come up and ask me to watch their matches, and I always tell them that always remember it is our job to make the wrestler's job easier. And it's entertainment. I mean, let's face it. You go to a ballet, you're paying to be entertained. A movie, any sporting event, you're paying to be entertained. And I thought, why not, you know, give as much as I can? I was somewhat athletic in nature anyway, and I thought it helped. And it just came naturally. Nobody told me to do it. I never studied it. It just came naturally, the dives and that sort of thing, sliding across and being very animated. You know, the people at ringside, they can pretty much tell what's going on. They can hear a lot of it, and they're close by. But the people way back in the upper deck and the stands, they can't hear it too well. So you got to try to be as animated as you can to let them know what's going on, because, hey, they paid their money too.
Mm-hmm. And always, to me, it always made it really seem like important, like you're really trying to, you know, do all you can to get on the count.
Well, you know, different wrestlers require different things, and some wrestlers. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's all right. Just a caller calling in. If anyone calls in, just wait till we get to you, and we'll call on you. Go ahead, Tommy.
Okay. All righty.
No problem. You go on, Tommy.
Well, I was just saying I lost my train of thought for a moment, but I always try to be as animated as I could. You're trying to make everybody realize what's going on, and it just came naturally to me. I got into it, and, you know, I'd get close to a wrestler. Ricky Steamboat might have an arm lock on Ric Flair, and Ric Flair would be screaming, and I'd be asking him, how about a champ? You had enough? Whoa, I think you might have a cavity in that upper bicuspid there. You know, there were so many things that happened. I could go on all night. You're going to have to cut me off every so often because I'll talk you to death.
All right. Well, we'll let everybody know before we get too far into the interview. You're going to be at the NWA Legends Fan Fest. That's August 5th through the 8th in Charlotte, North Carolina. And you get all your ticket information on NWALegends.com. There's a link right on our website.
Oh, yeah.
Now, you've been here before. You were here the last few years, I believe.
Well, I didn't make it last year. You know, Greg Price, the gentleman that runs these things, and he's becoming legendary in his own right. The first one was in 2004, and then he's been pretty much doing them on a regular basis. He bounces around a little bit. The one year they did it, I think, in might have been Baltimore or a suburb of Baltimore. I didn't go to that one.
Yeah.
But I've been on two or three or four of them, and they're a lot of fun. I really like to intermingle with the fans. You know, they made us. Without the fans, we were nothing. That put dinner on the table. And I have a lot of respect for the fans, even though I caught a lot of flack from some of the fans down through the years. But I love these Legends reunions because it takes me back. My career has been over for some time. But occasionally I get back in the ring and we'll do a match. I'll be doing some, I believe, at the reunion. I'll be refereeing. I'll be doing the question and answer session with my old buddy Jim Cornette.
Oh, excellent.
We'll do a Johnny Carson, Ed McMahon type of thing where I'll go through the audience and, you know, take questions for Corny. And Corny gets one of his famous nosebleeds like he did the one year and the first one. I'll take over until he gets back. Whatever's got to be, we'll do it, and I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. Now, actually, the one in Baltimore, that was the first year that we went to it. It was a lot of fun. Yeah.
I missed that one, unfortunately.
Yeah. Now, you said you're going to you might be a referee on one of the matches. Do you know which match? Do you think it'll be a Legends match, or will it be some of the younger guys?
Well, I don't know what the matches are going to be yet. I don't know that they've been even scheduled. I hope it's a Legends match because, you know, I can't keep up with these young guys. It's a little difficult for me. I keep myself in somewhat decent condition. I'm overweight. I mean, generally speaking, when I repped, I stayed somewhere in the neighborhood of 180 pounds. Now I'm down to about 200, was up to 215. It looked like I was pregnant, and I can't stand that. So by the time the Legends Fan Fest occurs.
Can I speak to Tommy, please?
I'm sorry.
Just go on, Tommy.
Hello?
I hope to be on about 195 pounds. I'm just over 200 now, and I'm trying to bring it down as best I can. But getting back to your question, I hope to do a Legends match. I might even do a younger guys match. Shucks, I don't know what I'm going to do, but whatever it is, I'm going to give it everything I got, brother.
No, I believe the one year you ref the Rock and Roll Express versus Midnight Express match.
Oh, yes.
No, what was that like, you know, being back in the ring with all four of those guys? We're all five, if you include Jim Cornette.
Well, it was great. I mean, you know, these are guys that, God, it was so much fun to ref them. I mean, when the Rock and Rollers and the Midnighters came in, I think they came in either 83 or 84. And just tore the place down. I mean, everywhere they went, these teams complimented each other. They knew each other well. And, of course, there's the world-famous Cornette with that tennis racket. Good God, was that a heat-getter. And it was just so much fun. It was constant action, and it kept me in shape trying to keep up with them.
Yeah.
And I loved it, and I still do. I don't know that I'll be doing that match again, but if I am, I can't wait. I just don't know right now.
Was there any anything that ever sticks out with like Cornette at ringside? Anything you know, during one of the matches that sticks out in your mind?
Corny and I used to do a deal where I would catch one of his guys doing something, and he'd get upset and he'd jump up on the apron, take off his suit coat. Corny was always wearing a suit with the racket, of course, and he'd get into the ring, and we're all standing back like, what is this? And then he'd get down and do the push-up that the women do, where you're on your knees doing it. And then I'd say, wait a minute, you don't do it that way. And then I'd get down and do 10, 15, 20 push-ups. I do a lot of push-ups. I've always done them, so they're easy for me. And then we'd start boxing, and I'd start throwing jabs at him, never catching him, and he'd get scared and run behind one of his guys, and it was something that we did. It was a lot of fun. There was so much that you could do. I don't know that anything in particular stands out, because one match was as great as the other. They were all so much fun, and you made money, too. The buildings were packed. The little girls were crazy about Ricky and Robert, the Rock and Rollers. And Dennis and Bobby originally, and then later on Stan and Bobby. And it was great working with all of them because, of course, Corny was there, and Corny would carry so much heat. And but if anything particularly stands out, I really can't think of anything because from one match to 100, they were all great, every one of them. I relished them. I always will.
Mm-hmm. We got some people on hold here who's trying to call and ask you a question. Just a reminder, if you call in, just be quiet till we get to you, and then we'll get to you. But we actually have a caller here, Shane. He's calling in from Ireland.
Ireland, wow.
Hi. My question is, did you ever think Jerry Lynn would become World Heavyweight Champion?
All right, forgive me. I didn't understand that. Could I get that question again, please?
Yeah, he wanted to know if you remember refereeing for Jerry Lynn and if you ever thought he would be become a big star. I don't know if you were around when he came into wrestling.
No, I did not referee that individual, sir. I'm sorry. I wish I could tell you more. I never had an opportunity to go to England or Ireland. I know that they go there now. I know they had that big show a number of times in Wembley Stadium. You must understand that my career ended at the end of 89, and the traveling really picked up not too long after I retired, and I never had the opportunity to go to Ireland or England or Europe or Asia, Japan. These are common stops now, and I wish I please forgive me for not answering your question better, because frankly I just can't. I wish I had been around, but unfortunately I had an injury that ended my career, and I never got a chance to go over there. But I know that the Irish and the English and all the fans from around the world have been great for wrestling, and I'm very grateful to them. And I really appreciate the question, but I just wish I could answer it, but I can't.
Thanks for calling in, Shane.
Is it your birthday on Friday?
He wants to know if it's your birthday Friday.
Yes, it is. My God, I appreciate you saying that, sir. I'm not really looking forward to birthdays anymore. I'm going to be 63, and you know it's funny. My birthday is exactly the same of all people, O.J. Simpson. We are the same age, July 9th, 1947, who I was a big fan of once, more obviously. But I appreciate the question, sir, and I appreciate you realizing that. And I love Ireland. I've got a little bit of Irish blood in me, and I appreciate that.
Thanks for calling in, Shane.
Thank you, Shane. Best wishes to you.
You don't own a white Bronco, do you?
Do I own a white Bronco?
Right.
No, I own a green Toyota.
All right.
I work for a Toyota dealership here in Charlotte, and I bought a Toyota, the first foreign car, although I really don't feel it's foreign because they're made in this country. But, no, I drive a green Toyota, not a white Bronco.
Right. Andrew, do you have a question from the board?
Yeah, I have a question. Ricky Ferguson Jr. from Facebook, he wants to know, he was wondering what was the most extreme thing you saw a wrestler do to protect the business?
To protect the business?
Uh-huh.
Wow. Boy, that's a good one, Rick. I hate to draw a blank on this, but the intensity of different wrestlers. If anybody ever gave his heart and soul to this profession, I would say above all, it may be Cactus Jack, Mankind, Mick Foley. I think his real name is Mick Foley. Maybe.
Mm-hmm.
He'd do anything. I mean, he'd make you believe it because it was real. This man would fall on tacks. He'd get hit with barbed wire. I didn't get a chance to referee him. He'd been around before I got hurt, but he wasn't in the NWA yet. He came along later and, of course, went on to the WWE. He's had quite a career. But my God, he would do anything. He would, if anybody didn't believe in professional wrestling, just watch Mick Foley. And another one is Terry Funk. Terry Funk would do anything. He'd go into the audience and argue with people, and people would hit him, and he wouldn't even get upset about it because he went into the audience.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like he had, oh, that guy hit me, I had to get him back. Not Terry. And I'd grab him and I'd pull on him, and he will be at the Fan Fest, Terry
yep.
Funk. God, what a hero of mine he is.
Mm-hmm.
I can't wait to see him and his brother Dory. But Mick Foley and Terry Funk, Rick, would do anything for our profession. They would bleed, tacks. You could hit him with, well, Terry was going around with a chainsaw when he was calling himself Chainsaw Charlie.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think he ever used the saw on anybody, thank God. That would be kind of hard to work. But you know, I mean, these two guys, and there were so many. I mean, but I will tell you this. Now it's something is coming to me, and this is a little difficult. One night, and are you there, Rick?
Well, he sent in the question. He typed it into us.
All right, should I tell this story?
Oh, we want to hear it. The juicier, the better.
Well, I believe this was 1984. Ricky Steamboat against Ric Flair for the world's title. We were in Charlotte, North Carolina, right here where I'm calling from, at the old Independence Arena, which is still there and great for wrestling. Had about the building was packed, about 11,000 people. It wasn't a real super huge building, but about 20 minutes, maybe it was 30 minutes. It had to be longer than that because they would always go so long. Steamboat slammed Flair, and he grabbed a reverse face lock on him after he tried to get a pin, and Flair came out of it. And I went down to ask Flair, you give up? And I got hit with the worst smell in my life. It about knocked me down. And I leaned in and I said, all right, which one of you guys farted? And Flair said, I shit my tights. Now, please forgive my, you know, I know we're on the radio and I apologize for saying that. But that's what he said. And this particular night, Rick was wearing pink tights and pink boots. Well, Steamboat just looked at me and kind of rolled his eyes. He wouldn't say anything. But what was really funny was that the smell started getting outside the ring. And the people sitting at the table were looking at each other, and then it's getting to the fans. And they're looking at each other, and Now, people way up in the balcony, like I was talking earlier, they don't know what's going on. But, boy, the people around ringside did, and they worked their way to their feet. Now, mind you, Flair's done a little bit of a job in his britches. This is the only time this has ever happened that I remember. But they actually continued to wrestle another 6-7 minutes because it wasn't time. They were protecting the wrestling show. It wasn't like, oh, we got to get out of here. This didn't happen. They continued to wrestle. And it was, I don't want to go in any more detail. Flair might kill me. You know, I mean, it's tough to talk about because I'm not saying this to embarrass him. I'm saying this to put over what a professional he was. I mean, he must have eaten too late, and the slam must have caused something. You know what I'm saying. It can happen to anyone.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And they continued to wrestle another 6-7 minutes, never mind anything, smell, whatever. They continued to wrestle, and they didn't go until it was time to go. And to me, nothing is more professional than that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't mean to embarrass Flair. He might put the figure four on me at the Fan Fest. I don't know what he's going to do. I don't even think he's going to be there. I hope he isn't.
he might be coming now.
Well, I tell you, yeah, he might be at the door in a few moments, but he lives not too far away from me. But this is to tell you what a professional both he and Steamboat were. And I'm sure you know that Steamboat's just been through something very traumatic.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I've actually heard you're good friends with Steamboat.
Well, yes, Flair and Steamboat, I idolized them. I mean, you know, I can tell you how good I thought I was and all that baloney, but you still have to get the opportunity to do this. And I had the opportunity to work so many of their matches. And they always wanted me for their matches because I could do things that other referees couldn't do to help the match. And these guys were such pros. To me, they are the Steamboat is the greatest baby face, and Flair is the greatest heel I've ever seen. And it's tough for me to say that because there are so many people that I love to work with. There are so many great performers. I mean, I could go on the Funks, the Briscoes. I mean, you know, you could go on forever about people that I really love to work with. But Flair and Steamboat, they complemented each other's styles so well. And the first match that they first had in 1977 was as good as the ones they did in 1989, not too long before I had to retire. And to me, they are the greatest. I'm close to Steamboat. I stay in touch with him. I was close to Flair some years back. I'm not as close to him as I used to be, but we stay in touch a little. He's a very busy man. Steamboat just was injured on TV recently, and it was a pretty traumatic injury, but he's improving. I understand he will be back home in Carolina pretty soon if he's not back here already. But to me, those two are the greatest, and I pray for Ricky Steamboat. He's a great friend and a great wrestler.
You're actually on his the recent DVD that WWE put out, the Ricky Steamboat DVD. Have you seen it? Have you seen the finished project?
Yes, I have. They called me. You know, I was stunned that they didn't call me for the Flair DVD. That surprised the living daylights out of me. But they didn't. And maybe they, you know, realized their mistake. Maybe they, I don't know what it was. If it was a mistake, that depends on who you talk to. But they did give me a call that they wanted to do the DVD with Steamboat, and they liked to interview me. And, of course, I was very honored to do it. And they sent a camera crew here to Charlotte, the WWE. They are very professional people. Vince has always been very nice to me. I did a couple shows for him in 98, but I don't want to get away from your question. They came here, and we went to a hotel. And I sat down, and they asked me a number of questions about Steam. And, of course, I ranted and raved and yapped like I'm doing now. And I thought, well, you know, they'll take one segment of it and put it in the DVD. Well, they sent me the DVD. I just got it the last week. And they go back to me 5 or 6 times. And I was very honored to do that. They compensated me well. They're a very professional organization, and it's an honor to be in that DVD.
Mm-hmm. Did you think they did a good job on it?
I felt that they did. To tell you the truth, I haven't seen the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
There are three discs to the DVD. I saw the first one where it's interviewing different wrestlers, you know, Flair and Harley Race and me and a number of others that wrestled him. And the second tape, of course, had some of his matches. I haven't seen too many of it yet. I will continue to watch it as I go, and I will get to the third DVD. So I've only actually watched the first disc and part of the second. From what I'm told, that they didn't have too many of the Flair Steamboat matches on the DVD. Have you seen it yourself?
I haven't seen the whole thing either. Barbie, did you see all the matches?
I haven't managed to check out the DVD yet, or it's at the top of my to-get list.
Mm-hmm. Of course, okay, well, I don't feel so bad that I haven't seen that yet. So
usually,
we're both guilty of that, old buddy.
Just usually with those, I like to check out the documentary part first, because a lot of times I've seen a lot of the matches. So, you know, I check those out later.
Well, you know, you want to see what you did and how you did it. And the funny thing about it was they asked me about what I thought was really pretty about, you know, the different moves that Steamboat did.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing that always stood out with me was he threw such a beautiful drop kick. The drop kick always landed right in the guy's chest. And I mean, he got up so high, and I was always impressed with his drop kick. But yet what they really talked about more was his arm drag, which is also classical,
yeah.
Which he basically, he said in the DVD that he studied Jack Briscoe. Jack, bless his heart, may he rest in peace. Wonderful man there. He was great. You know, you talk about matches that you wish you could have done. I never had the opportunity to do any of the Dory Funk Jr. Jack Briscoe matches. They were classics. I think they came as close to Flair and Steamboat as any match could. And I would have really loved to do one of their matches, but I never had the opportunity because I pretty much stayed in Carolina. I did go down to Florida for a while in 82, but they weren't wrestling each other back then. But Jack Briscoe and Dory Funk Jr., I missed doing them, and I always wished that I could. I have tremendous respect for both of them. Jack has passed on recently. Dory will be at the Fan Fest. I'm looking forward to see him.
Yeah.
But like I said, you know, I was always impressed with Steamboat's dropkick, but it was the arm drag that got all the coverage on the DVD.
Yeah. His son does the same arm drag, Richie. Have you seen him wrestle?
Now, who now?
His Ricky's son, Richie Steamboat.
Oh, Richie. Yeah. Oh, God, what a kid.
Yeah, he's really
I'd like to have 10% of his future.
Yeah.
I mean, his attitude is so good. He's humble, and he's such a handsome kid. He's got a great body, great attitude. He's training, I believe, in the training school in Florida now.
Mm-hmm.
Steam brought him up the hard way. I mean, he didn't cut him any slack. He first started working under George South, who trains guys here in Charlotte. George is very good. And then I think he sent Richie to Harley Race's camp in, I believe it's Kansas City. And then I believe Richie was also training in Japan. And, boy, I hear that's grueling there.
Yeah.
And now I believe he's down in Florida at the training school that WWE has down there. But I believe this kid will make it all the way. He's got everything. I can't think of – he doesn't have any weaknesses that I'm aware of. I haven't seen an interview yet. Of course, you know, it's kind of early for that.
Mm-hmm.
But, boy, I'd like to have a piece of his future. He's going to make it. I really hope he does. He's a great kid.
Yeah. Now, we got some more people here who want to ask you a question. We got I'm not sure what the name is, but he's from All-Star Wrestling.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah, Henry.
Henry, all right.
Yeah. Tommy, first off, I want to say when I first got in the business, I started in 91. I started out as a referee, and I tried to imitate you as much as I could. And, you know, I did the little slide out of the ring thing and the flyover. And it got me over as a referee, and I want to thank you for that.
Well, I thank you very much. It's very nice of you. But now remember, you always want to have your own style. Dickie Slater, you remember Dickie, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Dickie, for some reason, he idolized Terry Funk like I do. But Dickie was doing so many of Terry's moves that when you saw Dickie, a lot of times you were thinking of Terry. You know, you were seeing Terry. And, you know, you don't want that. Dickie is so good that he didn't have to do that, but he loved Terry so much and he loved the things that he did that he copied a lot of them, and you got to be careful there. Now, one time, I'm sure you know Charles Robinson from the WWE.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Now, Robbie's a good friend of mine. I tell people he's my protege. He isn't. But, you know, we were doing an interview one time with a gentleman, and it was on, I forget where it was. I'm still computer stupid. But Robbie said that he did something that I did, and of course George South, who was there with us, said, "Oh, he's copying your style, Tommy." And I said, "Now come on, George. Robbie doesn't copy my style. When you see Robbie, you don't see me. You see Robbie. He's got his own style, and that's what you got to have, brother. You pick up things that you know that you see. You try to enhance them, improve on them, and I'm sure you know I've seen guys that do stuff now." I couldn't do. I'm going to be honest about it. And I'm thinking, boy, there is some great talent out there in a number of the referees. have come up to me and asked me, please watch my match and tell me what you think. I said, well, always remember, you know, you have to have your own style. When they see you, you don't want them seeing Tommy Young. You want them seeing you.
Mm-hmm.
But always remember, and I said this earlier in the interview, I don't know if you heard it, but always remember, it is our job, the referee, to make the wrestler's job easier. That is the most important thing you can do. The wrestlers will love you for it, and you'll be appreciated, and your bookings will probably improve, because it's a team effort. It's two wrestlers and a referee. Two great wrestlers can get around a bad referee. It's possible. It's been done for God knows how long. But it's so much better when the wrestler doesn't have to worry, is the referee going to be there? Can he do this? You want to do as good a job as you can and be, you're part of that match, and you're such an important part because you control, you know, you have the final say in the match. But you've got to have your own style. I appreciate you saying those things to me. I never get tired of hearing them, and I hope I hear them all night. but to tell you the truth, I appreciate everything you've said. Keep at it. But remember, it's our job to make the wrestler's job easier. Never forget that, and always try to pattern your style after that.
And one more question I want to ask.
Now, can you speak up a little bit? I'm having trouble hearing you.
I'm sorry. There was one more question I wanted to ask. Actually, I was going to ask, you know, I saw the Steamboat DVD, and, you know, I figured that was your favorite, you know, singles match to referee, and I was going to ask who's your favorite tag team matches to referee, and then, of course, you answered that earlier with Midnight and Rock and Roll. So my question now is, and I don't want to put you on the spot, but were there any guys that you really didn't enjoy working with?
Individually or tag team, or what are you talking about? Specifically?
Just all around. Well,
without a doubt, my most non-favorite guy to referee was Cowboy Stan Hansen. Remember him?
Yes, sir.
Guy was brute force. He broke Bruno Sammartino's neck.
Mm-hmm.
And but the problem with Stan, he wasn't really the nicest guy in the world. Now, I'm not saying he was a jerk. Maybe we just had a clash of personalities. I don't know. But another thing with Stan, he was brute force. Plus, he couldn't see very well. And when he took his glasses off, he had trouble seeing. And as we say, he was potatoing everybody himself. I mean, Idaho was very well represented. He was doing a number on people, and it wasn't like, you know, hey, you hit me, I hit you back. He didn't go for that. From what I understand, and I don't know that this is true, but I heard that it was, he was wrestling Bam Bam Bigelow. Remember him?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yes, sir.
You know, Bam, I think, is deceased now. He was a good guy, but he was a big, tough, scary guy. And I heard a story that, you know, Hansen was, you know, knocking his brains out. So he was coming back at him, and Hansen didn't like it and just hauled off and cold-cocked him, knocked him right out. And I understand that there is it's on the Internet. I don't know what it's on, but it was a match in Japan. Stan Hansen did a lot of wrestling in Japan, probably because nobody in America wanted to wrestle him. But anyway, he did a lot of wrestling in Japan, and he wrestled a guy named Big Van Vader. You probably remember Vader.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
And Vader's a big, huge guy himself. And I've been told that you can see that. I just got a computer, so I'm computer stupid so far. And I haven't seen that yet. But I heard it's just brutal. They are literally beating the living hell out of each other. I heard that Vader's eyes were all closed up, and
it actually pops out of his head.
Well, there you go. You've seen the match?
Yeah.
I heard it's brutal.
Yeah.
I heard it's almost frightening, but I didn't like Stan. One night, we were in Greensboro, North Carolina, and it was Ole Anderson, there's a classic, and Stan Hansen, and I don't even remember who they were wrestling. I didn't know Stan that well then. And something happened, and he shoved me. So as a referee, I'm supposed to, establish authority. I shoved him back. He shoved me back kind of stiff. I shoved him back. Next thing I know, he put me in orbit. He hit me with both of his hands in the shoulders, and I went flying across the ring, landed on the back of my head, and like, damn, what the heck? And I'm sitting up half stunned, and Ole yells at me from outside the ring, you get up and you give him, oh, I hate to say this, but you give him shit. And I said, I can't even get up. I mean, he just, his strength was incredible. So he was difficult, you know, because he, you know, it was like, you know, I can do anything to you, but don't you do anything back. And, right. You know, most guys, they hit you hard, they'll say, okay, let me have the receipt. Not this guy. He wasn't like that. And he was difficult for me. I made my peace with him, but it was an uneasy peace. He's such brute force. He was the worst. And I would say number two would have to be my old buddy, Abdullah the Butcher. Abdullah would come into the ring with a gimmick the size of a Mack truck, and I've got to act like I can't see it, and I could have 10 blindfolds on and I couldn't miss it. and you know, I got to the point where, hey, come on, Abby, you're killing me. I mean, I'm not supposed to DQ him, and he's walking around with something about 10 times the size of a ball peen hammer, and I got to act like I don't see it, and the fans would get on me, why don't you do something? I said, you got any suggestions? So, you know, those two guys were tough. I mean, I'm not saying they're bad guys, but they were difficult for Tommy Young. And those two pretty much stand out. I've talked about them in other interviews. I'm not saying they're bad guys, and maybe one of them or both of them will strangle me at the fan fest. I don't know. There's always that chance. But they were very difficult. And then there were guys that I loved to work with also. But those two, they stand out.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for calling in, Henry.
Thanks, bud.
Thank you, Henry. Best wishes to you. Hope to see you at the Fan Fest.
Yeah, I plan on being there. I'm only like 45 minutes from Charlotte, so I'm planning on going.
Look me up, brother. Look me up. I love to talk to the fans.
Yeah, right, definitely.
Thanks, buddy.
Good.
Now, I just say, we mentioned a couple times about both the Funk brothers are going to be there, and that's really cool to me because actually Terry Funk's probably like, I'd say he's my favorite wrestler of all time. Now, well, how would you compare the two? Obviously, they're much different in the ring.
Oh, Terry and Dory, they're like night and day.
Mm-hmm.
Dory was the consummate wrestler. He was, you know, very serious, very low-key. I mean, it's hard to believe they're brothers.
Yeah.
I mean, Dory was so low-key, and, well, in fact, it was Steamboat himself used to. Remember the song Sad Eyes? Sad Eyes, turn the other way.
Right.
Steamboat used to call Dory Sad Eyes because Dory, there wasn't much emotion in Dory. Terry was as emotional as Cornette, Bobby Heenan, and Ric Flair rolled into one. I mean, Terry was the dead opposite of Dory. Dory was a great, great world champion because he was such a great wrestler, and Dory carried the belt for 4 years from 69 through 73. Terry only carried it about 1 year because you just never knew what Terry was going to do, and that's what was so much fun. I mean, Terry would get on his hands and knees and run across the ring and headbutt you. I mean, Terry would go into the audience. He'd do anything. There was nothing that Terry wouldn't do. And you know, he complimented the matches. But you just never knew what Terry was going to do, where Dory was just the opposite. He was the consummate pro, and I hope you don't misunderstand me here by calling Dory a consummate pro. I'm not trying to take anything away from Terry. I love Terry to death. In fact, when I call him, and he's one of the few guys that I will call occasionally, I call him Morgan because, you must have seen Roadhouse. It's been on about 5,000 times.
Oh, yeah.
And it'll probably be on another 5,000. And every time you see it, it's a good movie.
Mm-hmm.
And his character in the movie was Morgan. And Terry was so good at that because Terry was just being Terry, beating the hell out of somebody or getting the hell beat out of him. So he didn't have to act. He was just being himself. And he played such a great role in that movie. And he was also close to Patrick Swayze, who just died not too long ago, because they're both Texans. And Texans have a way of kind of sticking together. Dickie Murdoch, bless his heart, was a great friend of Terry's. And like I said, the Texans kind of stick together. And Swayze was from Texas. And, you know, you talk about Terry. Here's a little story. We were in the Howard Johnson's in Atlanta, where we used to stay. And I was hanging out with Terry in the bar. And the girl that took care of us, gave us a rate and everything, her name was Delaine. She came into the bar and said, Terry, you've got a phone call. And Terry went out there, and I went with him. And I guess I didn't hear what was going on the other end of the phone, but apparently Patrick Swayze was in town for something, and he was over at the Marriott. And he said, hey, Terry, let's get together and have a drink, man. I'm in town. Let's get together. Terry says, Murdoch, don't you try that stuff with me. I know you. You can't fool me, Murdoch. And hung the phone up, and we went back in the bar. Well, okay, now, a few minutes later, Delaine comes back. Terry, you've got another call. And Terry says, oh, for Pete's sake, come on, Tommy. So I went with him. And same thing. Terry, cut this bull tweet. I'm guessing what he's saying because I couldn't hear what Swayze was saying.
Mm-hmm.
But Terry's saying, Murdoch, I told you, you're always pulling this stuff on me. And he was. Dickie was like that. I'm not going for that stuff. I'm having a drink. I'm doing fine. You ain't fooling me. I ain't going for that bleep. And hung up again. We go back in the bar again. Well, about an hour later, after we're both hammered and we're heading back to our rooms, along with several other guys, Barry Windham was there. Yeah, a number of guys were there. And Delaine said to Terry, Terry, what kind of an individual is Patrick Swayze? It would be neat to meet him. And Terry says, oh, Delaine, that wasn't Swayze. That was Dick Murdoch messing with me like he's always doing. And Delaine says, well, Terry, I know it wasn't Dick Murdoch because he was here between phone calls. I know it wasn't him. I saw him. It wasn't Dick Murdoch. And Terry goes, oh, no. So he calls the Marriott. And gets a hold of Swayze. Swayze says, oh, you finally decide, and I guess, again, I'm paraphrasing. I don't know what Swayze said. He said, well, I'm in bed now. You had your chance. I'll talk to you later. And he hung up on Funk. So the whole thing was a complete misunderstanding. Terry thought Dickie was playing a trick on him. And Swayze, I guess, had to do something the next day. He had to get up. So he couldn't get out of bed and go back, get together with Terry. I mean, it was too difficult to do that. I don't know if they saw each other the next day or not, but the whole thing got screwed up that night because Terry thought Murdoch was playing a rib, and it really was Patrick Swayze. And, of course, Murdoch had a good laugh when he found out about it. So, it, you know, there are so many stories I can come up with, but that one happened.
Barbie, do you have a question?
Absolutely. James Knight wants to know, what advice could you give to a referee starting out in wrestling?
What advice could I give to a referee? I missed that last part.
Starting out in wrestling.
Starting out in wrestling.
Absolutely.
Well, you know, times are different now. In my case, when I broke in, they didn't have a referee that night, and I just told them, you know, I was on first as a wrestler. I said, let me do it. I think I can do it. And I had a basic knowledge of wrestling. Why I had it, I don't know, because nobody ever taught me anything about that. I mean, as a wrestler, I was about as useful as a screen door in a submarine. But as a referee, it was a different thing completely. Now, starting out as a referee, I would say the best thing to do is to always be there for the wrestlers. Actually getting your foot in the door, I don't know how to tell you that because everybody's situation is different. Things are different now. Did I say something funny? I mean, what's going on? Anyway, it's a tough one, and I wish I could help you. But always be there for the wrestlers. Be close. You know, I always worked very close to the wrestlers. Sometimes you catch an elbow to the nose or something like that, you know, or sometimes you might get a little too close, but you want to be there for them. It's like I tell all the other referees, and I've said this several times tonight. I don't know that you heard this. I'm going to say this again. Always remember, it's our job to make their job easier. So always be there. You want it. You want the wrestlers to like you. You want them to know that whatever they do, you'll be there for it. Am I missing something? I hear a lot of giggling in the background.
We got a call. You might know him. He's going to be at the Fan Fest too, I believe. Jack.
How you doing, Tommy?
Who have I
Jackie
got here?
Crockett.
Jack Crockett. Woody, are you going to be there?
Yeah.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing you. I was telling him earlier how sometimes I jump over the wrestlers and you'd be there, you know, with the camera on your shoulder. Sometimes I'd slide into you, and sometimes you'd belt me in the leg, and then I'd kick you.
Oh, yeah.
We used to go at it all the time. But you did some great stuff, and they said you were going to be on. I was looking forward to that. But did we lose the other gentleman? I didn't mean to cut him off. I hope if he's still listening, just be there for them. Get in shape. One thing that you wanted to do, and I always tried to do this, try to be as small as you can, because it makes the wrestlers look bigger. I mean, I always try to stay about 180 pounds, and you know, that's important. You need to be in shape. You don't want – there are so many fat wrestlers – not fat wrestlers, but fat referees from the olden days. You don't see fat referees hardly anymore. You don't see fat wrestlers anymore. I saw a fat one on the WWE the other night.
Tommy, why don't you explain to them about cheap heat? You know, they put all the heat on the referee instead of on the wrestler, the individual wrestler. It's just cheap. You're throwing the crap off the referee.
Well, that depends on who's running the situation, you know, and there are ways to get around that to a degree. I mean, you know, you're never – the fans are going to automatically hate the ref. Don't they automatically hate the –
they automatically hate the official. But
still, go ahead.
You know, you're going through the matches and stuff, and the guys need to keep the heat. A real heel keeps the heat on himself. And,
Go ahead.
Yeah, he doesn't throw it off on anybody else. He's got to keep the heat on him. And, you know, you go through the stuff, and, you know, you sneak something here, or you do something there. But still, when it comes to the finish, you got to nail him.
Jack, you remember Gene and Ole, the Andersons?
Oh, God, yeah.
Those guys never put the heat on me. They were the most professional team. I mean, Ole was, you know, he's an overbearing Polack, but I love him. But they never put the heat on the referee. They kept it on themselves. You know yourself, Jack. A lot of guys just don't really know how to do that. It's an art. It's an art. That's one thing. You know, we talked earlier about what tag teams I love to referee, and they automatically thought, you know, the Rock and Rollers and the Midnighters, but for professionalism, nobody was better than Gene and Ole Anderson. They were the most professional team I ever saw. Ever.
They were the best heels going. Yeah.
Clearly.
They kept the heat on themselves. Even when Valentine and Greg came around, you know, they all kept the heat on themselves and stuff. You know, Flair was the greatest one. You know, he was the in-between, a babyface here and a heel there. But
you're right. And you remember Rick, one thing he would always do. You'd see me, I'd hook Steamer's arm, and he'd let Steamer have it, and the audience would go nuts. And I'd jump on Rick like, hey, what are you doing? And he'd shove me. And I'd shove him right back. And sometimes he'd start walking by me, and I thought, uh-oh. So I got to shove him from the side. He'd take a bump for me sometimes.
He took it all off of you.
There you go.
He took all the heat off of you, and he put it back on himself.
That says it all right there, brother. And
it's professionalism.
So good at that. Oh, yes. That says it all.
Now, When you're a referee, did you ever try to help the guys, like come up with moves for him or spots for him?
Hi, Jack, you quit giggling so much now.
No, I remember the Asheville that I think that you were the referee. We had a match in Asheville. He just came in from Japan, and he had this neon white shorts on, his wrestling trunks. And every time he'd take a slam, I thought he had a like a bubble gum stain on the back of his pants. He took another slam, the stain got bigger because he had diarrhea. We ended up throwing that match out.
Who are we talking about here?
Ric Flair.
Oh, well, did you hear earlier what I was saying about the match in Charlotte? That's the one where Rick crap, you know, shit his tights.
Thought it was Asheville.
No, it was Charlotte. It was Flair and Steamboat. I'll never forget about it. I was talking about it earlier. I mean, they were asking me about professionalism, and I said nothing was more professional than that. Rick crapped. I'm not going to say, you know, I'm not going to say that. I'm going to say crapped in his tights. And him and Steamboat wrestled another 8-9 minutes. That, to me, that's professionalism.
Yeah, we trashed the whole thing, but, you know, we had to keep going. That was the same place that some guy had opened a gym down the street, and my son had gone over, and the guy gave him a hassle, and whatever the preliminary guy was that was working in the ring helped out the gym manager and belittled my son, and that's where Ronnie Garvin had the guy in the ring, and we were just rolling a dead match while we were doing tape in the truck. And they beat the crap out of the guy.
Well, if anybody could do it, Ronnie could. Good God.
Yeah, because Ronnie over the guy, and Ronnie always had that one arm that was loose. Uh-huh. And he'd slap him, and he'd back him around. And you turned around and looked at me, because I told you, I said, if you finish the match now, I'll fire you.
Well, tell me, how's Chip? I haven't seen him in many years.
Oh, he's great. He's down in Florida. He's working with some people down there. It's a lawn company and stuff. He's been working with a couple of years now.
Okay, incidentally, guys, Chip is Jackie's son.
Oh, okay.
I want you to know what we're talking about here. Sure. Well, give him my best, Jackie, because Chip was awesome.
Oh, I will.
Yeah,
well, I will. Thank you.
But, yeah, that was Charlotte where that happened. I never forgot that. And, well, I tell you, you talk about a tough guy, Ronnie Garvin. Whoa.
Yeah, tough as nails.
Can you imagine Ronnie Garvin and Kevin Sullivan getting into a fight?
No.
I don't even want to think about it.
No, I would never step between them.
Somebody's going away in a hearse.
Yeah, I wouldn't step between them.
Somebody's going away in a hearse if those two fight. Whoa. Bad guys.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I got one I'll remind you of. You remember in Norfolk, Virginia? You wanted to ride back with me back to Charlotte, and you canceled out a ride with somebody else, and we ended up, it's like 5.5 hours, so we drove about 4 hours without stopping. You were about to explode because you were drinking beer.
Boy,
I messed with you that night.
Were you torturing me that night or what?
I got you.
I guess you did. I mean, that was get that six back and... And like you said, Norfolk was, that's about a 6-hour drive.
It's 6.5 hours, yeah.
Well, sometimes it would be dawn when you got home.
Yeah, but you're drinking your beers and stuff, and you canceled out a ride with somebody else because you're too cheap to pay the trans. And I had a broad with me, and so I'm hustling back. You know, if you hadn't been there because there's just the three of us, I could have had a good time. Yeah. Jerk. So
talk about being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Right?
Yeah. I made you suffer. But
yeah,
anyhow, well, we had a good life.
That.
Well, yeah. You learn not to cross me.
Well, I learned not to do that. Like I said, guys, if I bumped him sliding across the ring, he'd smack me in the leg or punch me or shove me or something. I mean, I had to worry more about Jackie than the match.
No.
I'm I'm exaggerating.
Like Manny, it's like, well, it's like Manny Fernandez. I didn't pay him enough attention. He'd throw a wrestler at me.
Good old Manny. I wonder if he'll be at the bar. He's always at the bar sitting at the corner at the fan base.
Yeah, and I bet he's still married to a redhead. The guy had 17, married 17 or 12 or something.
Were you at the fan fest a year that Manny was actually chopping a fan at the bar?
No, well, I may have been, but I missed that. What happened?
We were in the lobby and we heard it sound like a shotgun or something, and we went over and there was a fan who he pulled up a shirt and he was asking Manny he had a few to drink and he was asking Manny to chop him. And Manny just had this huge smile on his face, and he was he was dropping the hell out of the guy.
So I didn't hear anything about that, but knowing Manny,
one time he's gonna love that. You remember Henry Marcus?
Oh, of course, Henry.
He ran Charleston, Columbia stuff. Only chopped Henry one night after he asked him what the revenue was and broke his ribs.
Well, I don't sympathize too much. I was never real fond of Henry. But
Henry was all right.
I guess so. I just, I missed a lot of stuff because I was always in the ring, you know, and I wouldn't see stuff, you know.
I come around to Henry, complained about Henry's count, and so I take his ticket stubs and stuff and make sure everything was straight. But Henry was all right.
Okay, well, if you say so, I mean he could be cranky, you know that.
Oh well, hell, wouldn't I?
No, I'm not going to compare you to Henry Marcus. I'm not going to get myself in that kind of trouble.
Well, that's because I had somebody waiting for me in the car.
Yeah, Henry was quite a guy. He was our promoter in the South. He did like Jackie said, he would do Columbia and Charleston, Sumter.
He
would cover the lower part. The upper part of South Carolina was usually covered by either Sandy Scott, and then later on it was Danny Miller, you know, Greenville and Spartanburg and that. But yeah, Henry's one of our legendary local promoters.
Okay. Well, thanks for calling in, Jack. We got some people on hold, so we don't want to leave them on hold too long.
Yeah, no, y'all go ahead. I just want to say hello. Tommy, it's good to talk to you.
Jack, are you going to be at the Fan Fest?
Yeah, I'm down in Myrtle Beach now, but I'll be up there.
Okay, I'm looking forward to seeing you, brother.
Good luck,
bye-bye,
Tommy.
Bye-bye. Yeah, let's get some people on. I'm sorry for holding you up, folks. We get carried away.
Yeah, we had to take Jackie. Plus, he's laughing in the background.
Yeah, he's doing a lot of giggling, huh?
Yeah. Just so everybody know, again, it's August 5th through the 8th, Charlotte, North Carolina, NWALegends.com. There's so many people there. We already mentioned both the Funks will be there, Harley Race will be there, Greg Dimmer Valentine, The Assassin, Skandar Akbar, he just announced recently, Tony Atlas, Joe Blanchard and Tully Blanchard, Ted DiBiase, Kamala. Did you ever referee for Kamala?
Oh, yes. He came in a couple of times, not that often. He was in and out. But I didn't work with him too much, but he was a pleasure. He was a lot of fun. He was different. I mean, because he painted himself all up but like I said, he came in for specific things. He did not come into the territory for any period of time. He'd be in and out. But yes, I did referee Kamala, and looking forward to seeing him.
Yeah. Jim Ross was going to be there. Jim Ross actually going to barbecue for everybody. I believe it's on the first day of the event. Yeah, at Lakeside's going to be a Jim Ross barbecue. That's going to be pretty awesome.
What night is that? Do you know?
I believe that's the 5th. I think it's the first night. I'm not positive, though. I believe that's how they're going to open up the Fan Fest.
Well, I know they're starting Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to be doing question and answer things, you know, entertainment. Jim Cornette is doing the 10 o'clock session, and I'm just assuming I'm doing it with him because I've done two of them with him already. I've been calling him, but the Fink won't call me back. I know he will, but you know, you you call him up, and he's always got some goopy joke on his machine. Like he'll say, doctor, there's a man here that says he's invisible. And the doctor says, well, tell him I can't see him. You know, stuff like that. That's corny. That's the way he is. But he's supposed to be doing that at 10 o'clock, and I hope to assist him. I don't know who's doing it at 8. Maybe Jim's doing his thing maybe at 5 or 6 in the evening. I don't know. But I haven't seen Jim in a while. Hope he's doing well. He needs to be – are you there?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I bumped my phone. I wanted to make sure I didn't cut you off.
Oh, no.
They've got another guy that's doing it now with Jerry, who I think really does a poor job.
Yeah. Michael Cole?
Yeah, I think that's him. You know, I guess it's an opportunity for him. But they need JR back.
Mm-hmm.
I think they do. Jerry always did a good job, and I'm glad that he's still with them. He left them for a while, as I recall, and then he got his stuff straightened out. So, yeah, it'll be good to see Jim.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're actually going to do a photo op with Jim Ross and Bob Caudle together, which I think that would be really cool.
Oh, God, do I love Bob. Oh,
uh-huh.
Talk about legendary. Legendary. Bob Caudle is as good as they come. He had that folksy manner that just, it was so good. And I remember we had one of the Starcade shows. I think it might have been the second. I don't remember which one it was. But my old buddy, may he rest in peace, Gordon Soley, was coming in. And Bob was a little nervous, that, you know, because Gordon was such a legend that, you know, he might be getting replaced. And I told Bob, I said, Bob, you're too good. You don't have to worry. There's plenty of room for both you and Gordon. You guys will compliment. He was afraid that he would be overshadowed by Gordon.
Mm-hmm.
But Gordon did not do that. They complimented each other like bread and butter, you know, love and marriage, horse and carriage. They did it all. I'll never forget that. Bob Caudle is a true legend. I only wish that I could see my old friend Gordon Soley. He's been passed on for a while. But Bob Caudle is as legendary as they come. Everybody loves Bob Caudle. And he's a great family man. I'm sure his wife will be there. His sons are all like doctors, and he's got a lot to be proud of.
Yeah, a great voice.
Yes, I he was just great. He and David complimented him well,
mm-hmm.
and but Bob Caudle had that laid back, folksy manner. Yet he knew what he was talking about. He was just great, and he did it for so long.
Yeah. Let's see. We got a 760 area code. Who are you?
This is Shane out in California.
How you doing, Shane? You got a question for Tommy
Pretty
Young?
Good. Yes, it's an honor to talk to Tommy Young.
Thank
you, Shane. Watching him love watching you ref a match. I wanted to get your opinion on how you feel the role of the referee has changed from your era to the current era that we're in.
I tell you, Shane, that's that's a good question. You know, I don't know. I think I stood out somewhat when I did ref. I don't know that I would now so much, because the referee doesn't seem to be quite as much a part of it as he used to be. Now, I want to tell you, I think the WWE and at TNN, my old buddy Earl Hebner and his brother David, they're there. I never understood why they had to leave Vince. I feel that was a bad rap, but they're working over at TNN, and they have an excellent crop of referees in the WWE. Of course, my old buddy Charles Robinson is there. I call him Robbie, but you don't see that much interaction with the referees like you once did, and that's probably by design. I might have been, you know, held back. They might have said, well, you know, you're doing too much, or I don't know. It's really difficult. I think the referees do a hell of a job. I think the work ethic is excellent. There was a referee that I was watching the other night. I don't know his name because they don't talk about the referees.
I think there's actually it's like a policy that they're not supposed to mention their names on air.
And I don't understand why that is, because they always mention the referees in the UFC fights.
Yeah.
And in world boxing championship fights, the referee is always, announced. Now, of course, that's not true in, you know, basketball or football or hockey, although sometimes in baseball, I remember there was this big, fat Italian umpire. What was his name? He was very animated. A big, fat Italian guy. He's funny as hell. And but there were a number of umpires in baseball that stood out. But this referee the other night, WWE, I thought he was very good. He was getting in there close and getting down and doing the things that I think a referee should do. There was a situation, though, where I think it involved, it was two of their main guys. I'm getting older, so my brain is going, you must understand. But the referee was on the floor too much. And I would tell these guys, if the match spills out on the floor, you don't want to automatically start counting. Because if you get to 10 and they're not in there, what are you going to do? Mm-hmm. You know, so if it looks like they're going to be out in the floor a while, don't just stand in the ring like an idiot. Get out there with them. And I tell guys, I tell young referees, like, if the guy has got somebody in the corner, I've noticed some referees immediately start counting. You don't want to do that because the wrestler is trying to get his heat up. If you notice what I did, I would, like, grab a guy in the, grab him, tug at him a little bit, yell at him. And as a last resort, then I would put the count in. You know, you want to give them a chance to get their heat up. So the business, you got to remember, I've been gone over 20 years, and that's why I appreciate you saying that. Still remembering me that long, that could be that you've subscribed to Vince's legendary matches. I understand he's got something that's on 24 hours.
It's classics on demand, so you can watch the show anytime you want. It's really good.
I understand. I'm all over that from the older matches that he bought from Turner but I still think that the crop of referees is good, but they don't seem to be quite as involved as much as they once were. You don't see them getting taken out like I often was. I'm not seeing the right shows. I don't know, but the work ethic is very good. The referees are always—they look like they're in good shape, and I want to put my fellow referees over because they might come by and knock my brains out sometime. But the work ethic is excellent. But you got to remember, I never worked for Vince. I only worked two shows for him. In 1998, they did kind of an answer to the NWO. That was the one time that WCW was actually beating Vince. Vince was having trouble with that steroid scandal, and the NWO was hot. And so, in fact, my old buddy Jim Cornette called me up, and they wanted to do a deal where we were going to have like the an answer to that. We were going to have the NWA invading the WWE. And I did two shows for Vince in 98. They treated me like royalty. I was very appreciative. But they didn't go along with it. They cut it off right after that. The first night I refereed the Rock and Roll Express against a couple of young guys called the Headbangers. And I haven't seen them in a long time.
No.
And later on that night I did a match where Barry Windham beat the hell out of this jobber guy, and then Justin Bradshaw, there's a great guy, he came down to the ring and went after Barry with a bell, and I bailed out along with Barry, and that was that. And the following night, when we did the, I think it was the SmackDown show, we did it on Tuesday, I came down for a rematch between the Headbangers and the Rock and Rollers, and my old buddy Earl Hebner came down with another old friend of mine, Sergeant Slaughter, and, you're not a real WWE referee, get out of here. And me and Sarge argued all the way up the ramp. That was the end of it. They cut it off right after that, and that was the end of it. So that's the only work that I ever did for Vince. But with the Crocketts and WCW, I was very animated, and they loved it. And, the rest is history. I don't know that they want that up there now, because I don't see that much of it. Maybe it's just not there. I don't know what it is, but I don't really see anybody refereeing like I did. And that's good, because, you know, everybody needs to have their own style. But the business has changed somewhat.
Mm-hmm.
Nope. All I got to say is when I knew that Tommy Young was going to ref a match, I knew I was going to have a really good match. Because it takes two wrestlers, but you got to have that third piece, which is the referee, to make sure it flows perfectly.
Well, it's funny that you say that, because I always felt that, you know, when I came out that curtain, oftentimes I would hear the fans saying, "Oh, we got the good referee tonight." You know,
yes.
I used to say, you know, that, hey, you might love me, you might hate me, but you won't be bored. You're going to get your money's worth. I'm going to be out there. I mean, you are out there to be entertained. And
yes.
I felt that was important, and I really tried to do that, yet at the same time not to try to overdo it and outshine the wrestlers, because then they'd knock me out and you'd have to have another referee.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Thanks for calling in, Shane.
No problem.
Shane,
thanks. Take care,
Shane,
Tommy.
It's good talking to you, and you take care, brother. I'll see you down the
road.
Thank
you, sir. Thank
you for the kind words.
We have to get this question in, because it was sent in by actually Percy Pringle III. He wants to know if it was true that the Hebners taught you everything you know.
Tell Paul Bearer, my old buddy. You know, it's funny. I'm gonna tell you something. That night that I worked for Vince, the opening night in '98, we were in Dallas that night, and Paul, Percy Pringle III, whatever Paul wants to be called, I knew him as Paul Bearer.
Right.
But anyway, he had gone to the ring, I think, with The Undertaker, and some fan threw something, and it hit him in the eyes, and he was having a terrible time. I'm sure he's going to remember this. It was because he got hit with something, some kind of substance, a liquid, I don't know, but it gave him some trouble. But I remember him finally. He was a great guy, and he did a great job as the manager of The Undertaker, and he's a legend in his own right.
Mm-hmm.
But I had to share that with you. He caught something in the eyes. Some goofy fan got him, which sometimes happens to you. And he's a great guy, and it's good to hear from him even on a secondary basis.
Mm-hmm. He's actually going to be at the Fan Fest at one of the booths.
That's right. He's going to be there. I'll be looking for him.
Yeah.
I hope he doesn't throw something in my eyes. It could happen. You never know. Stranger things than that have happened.
Right. Let's see. We got Brandon calling in. Where are you from, Brandon?
I am from Spartanburg, South Carolina. How y'all guys doing?
Pretty good.
Well, that's close by.
Mm-hmm. Yes, all I have to do is take I-85, and boom, I'm right there in Charlotte. I will be at FanFest, so can't wait to meet you.
I'm sorry, your name is Brandon?
Yes, Brandon.
Okay, Brandon, look me up, because I'll be moving around the crowd. I'm not going to be trying to sell stuff and get you to buy everything you can. I don't believe in that. I mean, I'm there for the people. For God's sake, look me up. And, oh, do I have memories of the Spartanburg Memorial Auditorium.
Oh, yeah. Only 5 minutes from my house.
There you go. It's right there on 221. I know it well. Right across the street from the old Krispy Kreme that I think is closed up. I think it's across the street from there now. It's a bigger one.
Yeah, they built a bigger one, but the old Krispy Kreme remains. They just stack old supplies and stuff in there now.
You know, I thought so, because it looked like it was still open, but yet it wasn't. But I don't mean to get away from things. What can I do for you, Brandon?
Well, first, I have a comment and a question, but first I have to say you're my favorite referee of all time. It's not even close. No disrespect to Nick Patrick, Earl Hebner, and Randy Pee Wee Anderson. I can always remember when I was 4 years old, around 1989, when the Flair and Stevie matches were going on, and I would always remember watching WrestleMania 89, and I would always imitate your pinning style over and over and over again after watching that tape. And from there, I was a Tommy Young fan from the beginning. So first, I'd give you a major props. You're my favorite referee of all time.
Well, Well, what could I possibly add to that? Don't stop. Keep going.
As far as my comment goes, I remember watching some of the WWE classics on demand, and I never of course, I was only 2 months old when Starrcade 85 happened, but I would remember seeing your promo on WWE Classics a couple years ago after the Dusty and Flair match. And you were interviewed by Tony Schiavone, and I was just saying to myself, listening to you explain the finish, and I was like, I wonder why Jim Crockett Promotions didn't have you do promos a little bit more to explain some of the matches after, you know, after everything that happened, you know, after the matches and stuff. And I was just saying to myself, this guy is one hell of a promo. So, first, just have to say that.
Well, you know, back then, I remember the interview you're talking about. I think that was when I was wearing that ridiculous yellow blazer that I had. And, I mean, I look like a big canary. But, you know, I looked at that interview, and to tell you the truth, I was not all that happy with that interview. I felt that I was too contrite, too sorry. The one that I liked, the interview that I liked, and you know, I don't want to get the wrong impression. I mean, I appreciate you saying that. But the one that I really enjoyed was when Dusty wrestled Tully, and it was a money match, and Magnum was in Dusty's corner, and J.J. Dillon was in Tully's corner, and J.J. stole the money and ran out the building with it. And it was a match, while that was going on, Dusty covered Tully, but Tully's leg went over the rope. I didn't see it. Went 1, 2, 3. Dusty jumped up, and uh-oh, there's the leg. Well, did it go on the rope before or after the count of three? I don't know. Continue the match. Dusty bails out because he sees JJ taking off with the money. And he's running out. He's out in the parking lot at Greensboro, and I'm counting him out. So everybody got upset about that, and I came back. And Tony interviewed me about that later. I still got that one on tape. I was very proud of that. I appreciate you liking the one that I wasn't that super proud of. But like you said, they didn't talk to me that much. That just wasn't done with the referees. Once in a great while, it was done. In fact, early in my career, and of course you won't remember this because you were too young, in 1977, I actually did a one-hour color commentary with a man named Ed Caprell, who used to do our B show when we were running out of Raleigh, when we do our TV tapings there. And I did the whole show, and I don't know how good I was at that. And on top of all that, the guys gimmicked my coat where it was all strung up with string. So I had to walk out with my coat over my arm. I couldn't even put it on. The guys got me that way. I mean, I was easy to rib because it was so easy to get me because my stuff was always there. I'm always in the ring. But they didn't interview me much. The few times that they did, I thought it was okay. I think that was the one where I got knocked out of the ring and onto the floor, and I got knocked out. And another referee, Gene Ligon, came down and finished the match. But I got knocked out before I could disqualify the Horseman for attacking Dusty, because that match was Flair and Dusty, and I got knocked out. And then as I tried to get back in, Dusty kicked Arn Anderson right into me and knocked me out on the floor, and I'm laying there. And I remember, you can't move. You got to keep your eyes shut and not move. And after I saw it later, they had a spotlight on me. So it's a damn good thing I didn't move. And of course, the whole thing was a big controversial thing. And then I did the interview that you're talking about. I appreciate you saying that, but I really did not think I handled that interview very well, but it was probably because I just never did many interviews. But I appreciate your kind words.
You see, I think you did a tremendous job. The reason why I say this is because in wrestling today, you just don't have that sense of realism anymore. Like if a big controversial thing like that took place today, the WWE or TNA will just shrug it off. But back then, Jim Crockett Promotions had the, or at least Dusty at the time I think he was booking, they had the
presence of mind to say, hey, this is a big thing. So let's try to figure out the entire story from the referee's perspective. And then they interview you, and we got that story. And it was something like, you know, even like 15, 20 years later, I'm seeing it for the first time, and I'm like saying to myself, I can actually believe this. I mean, what if, you know, a big call like that happened in Major League Baseball or the NBA or something, and it cost someone the game? But, you know, the journalist will attempt to interview the referee at some point. And I'm like saying to myself, this makes a whole lot of sense. I could really get into this. And I just wish they would do some more stuff like that today.
Well, I hope everybody else thinks the same way you do. I mean, this is making me feel real good because I was not all that fond of it, and you thought it was great, so hopefully others did. But I do remember David saying, David Crockett, because he was there with Tony Schiavone. They were both talking. And, of course, David's being the good guy, and, well, you never made the call. And I remember saying, wait a minute, David, I made the call. I got knocked out before I could get the call to the commentator or to the announcer, but I made the call, and that was the call. I do remember that well. Like I said, there were only a few interviews that I did. They just didn't do that much, and that was fine. I mean, you know, leave that to the wrestlers. They did it every once in a great while, but I appreciate the fact that you like that and the believability of it, because that was so important back then. Some of that is gone now, and it's understandable. But, you know, this profession evolves, and that will continue.
Thanks for calling in, Brandon.
All right, thanks, guys, and I'll see you at FanFest, Tommy.
Brandon, you look me up. Make sure I know who you are when I see you, man.
I will be the one in the big Goldberg hat. I'm bringing that again, Jack.
Excellent.
All right, I ought to remember that. I hope I do. Thank you, Brandon.
He won it off the show. It's a big Goldberg to top hat. You can't mess him with that. In fact, Jim Cornette made him take it off before he took a picture with him.
So, I met him one time, Goldberg. There was a show in Columbia, South Carolina, and Arn and I were good friends back then, and I was going to go down with Arn, and Flair rode down too, and I was behind the curtain. We were on a stage, and Goldberg came up to me and introduced himself. He was a very nice person. That's the only time I ever met him.
Mm-hmm.
And he was very nice, very, very humble, you know, not bravado type of thing. Very nice guy. I only met him one time, but I thought he was a real gentleman.
Yeah. We had him on the show. He seemed like a really nice guy to us.
I'm sorry, what was that?
We had him on the show once, and he was really cool with us.
I'll bet he was. He comes across as a real good guy and big, powerful guy.
Yeah.
You want him on your side.
Definitely. Incher, you have a question?
Yeah, I actually had a question. If you were in the same situation that Earl Hebner was, how would you have handled the screw job?
Clarify that, please. What situation?
Shawn Michaels and Bret Hart screw job in Montreal.
Oh, yeah, wow. That was tough, and that was, God, no referee wants to be in that kind of a situation, but what can the referee do? I mean, who would you rather upset, Bret Hart or Vince McMahon? Who's paying you?
Right.
There's no question about that. I don't know Bret that well. I rep Bret a few times, mostly when I went to Toronto. He seemed like a nice enough guy. Didn't know him that well. I never understood why he covered his whole body. That's something I never understood. My point always was, you know, you don't cover your body in wrestling. I mean, you know, look at all the guys that they got. Steve Austin, Triple H, Randy Orton. I could go on. The Rock, you know, Flair, everybody, you wear just a little pair of tights. I never understood why. Now, I understand Shawn wearing the long tights. I understand why he does it, because he's always done that. But the vast majority of guys up there just wear tights. But Bret covered himself almost from head to toe. But I'm getting away from your question. I apologize. That is a horrible situation to be put in. But there's really not much you can say or do. I mean, you've got to do what the office tells you to do. And from what I understand, Bret was just very unreasonable about it. Now, I don't know that he was. I wasn't there. But it put Earl in a tough spot. But there's no question about it. When you have to do it, you have to do it. And he did it, and he got the hell out of there just like I would have, because Brett's going to be angry. But Brett has to know that Earl had to do that. Mm-hmm. If Earl doesn't do it, where does his paycheck go? You know? So it's really a very simple answer. It's a horrible situation to be in. I've never been in that situation. Thank God for that. I mean, I've been in situations where wrestlers got angry at each other, and I got in the middle of it. One that stands out is Sergeant Slaughter and Blackjack Mulligan, where they got into a fight in the ring, and I got in the middle of it and wound up with a hairline fracture of my shin bone.
Oh, my goodness.
But situations that big, where it's a huge... it was a WrestleMania, wasn't it?
Survivor Series, actually.
Okay, well, one of their big, huge pay-per-views, mm-hmm. and it's a terrible situation to be in, but Earl did the only thing he could do, the only thing any referee could do. I mean, when you're under orders to do it, and you know which side of the bread that it's buttered, so you just have to do it. I thought Earl handled it well. But Bret Hart should never be angry at Earl. I hope he never was, because Earl did what any referee would have to do. And that's really all I can say. I thought Earl handled it well. I would have done the same thing he did. I think any referee would. It's your bread and butter. You've got to do your job. And if the guy that's paying you the money tells you to do it, you got to do it.
Barbie?
Yeah, one of our fans, Michael, wants to know if it's true that you were the first referee to overrule your decision based on a instant replay.
Did I ever do that? Is that the question?
The question is, were you the first?
No, I don't know. I do remember, you know, I told you about that interview that I did that I was proud of between Dusty and Tully. When I went 1-2-3, and then the leg went over, and I continued the match because I didn't know. And then they show the tape later that shows the leg went over the rope after the three count, not before. Well, you always have to give the champion the benefit of the doubt because everybody's after the champion. You don't want the belt to change under controversy. It's got to be as legit as it can. Now, in that particular case, they pointed it out to me, and I apologized for that and said, I'm sorry. I'm sorry to Mr. Rhodes, to the audience, to everyone. But I also said, we simply do not use instant replays in professional wrestling. If you can go back and ever find that match, that's exactly what I said. And I said there will have to be a rematch, but I cannot reverse it regardless of what you've seen. It has to be that way. I mean, look what happened the other day with the umpire taking away the perfect game from the pitcher. You got to remember that.
Mm-hmm.
And that should have been changed where he called the runner safe. Are you familiar with what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I thought they're going to change that because that was so obvious and – but they didn't. They did not change it. The umpire's decision stood, and they pretty much tried to do that. I don't recall ever really reversing a match later on. Now, there were a couple times where, I think I know what you're talking about, like where I catch somebody with something after I've given the match. Or maybe I'm raising his hand and he stuck the gimmick under his arm, and when I raise his hand, the gimmick falls out of his arm. He thinks I'm going to raise the other arm, and I raise the one he doesn't expect, and then I go, aha, and I immediately have done that. But generally speaking, for big shows, there were hardly any decision reversals that I could think of. It just led to a rematch is all it would do. I hope that's I hope I answered that as satisfactorily as I could. That's a little tough, but every match is different. But generally speaking, I did not reverse many decisions.
Mm.
Let's see here. I just got more, a couple more people on hold, and we'll try to. So we've had Tommy on here for quite a while. We don't want to keep him here all night.
I love it. All right.
We got Carol on the line.
Hi, Carol.
Hey, Tommy Young.
Good to talk to you.
Oh, yeah. You remember me in 2007 when you gave me me and you talked, and you showed me your scar.
On my neck.
Yeah, and you gave me your name tag.
Oh yes, I think.
Yeah, so. And I'm related to Jackie Crockett.
No, okay. Yeah.
You probably remember me. I think it was in 2007. That was my first time going to the fan fest.
Okay.
And I'm coming back again this year, and because I know Jackie's going to be up there, and he's a real nice man, real good man.
You're coming
I'm coming up this year too.
Now, where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Myrtle Beach, South Carolina.
Okay. Well, you're right down there with Jackie, yeah.
Yeah, he's not too far from where I'm at, but nice. I'm originally from Spartanburg,
okay.
South Carolina.
I just talked to a gentleman that was there. He'll be at the Fan Fest too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, you know. I didn't get a chance to say thank you for your name tag that you gave me for a souvenir because you came up to me and you said, hey, would you like to have this for a souvenir? And I was like, yeah, cool. And
wasn't that the strap around my neck with the Tommy Young on it legend or something?
Yeah.
We all had those. Yeah, I gave a number of those. I've got a couple. But I did give a couple away. I know I would have appreciated it if somebody did that for me. So I'm glad you appreciate it, and I'm glad. I hope you still got it.
Oh, I still got it. I've got it in a picture frame, because I've got you and me in a picture that my friend Mark took when we were in the elevator.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got Jackie's picture with his sister Frances and his brother David. And I've got a picture of me and Jackie and Dustin Rhodes.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I've got a picture. Yeah, and I got a picture with Baby Doll. And I've got a picture of me and J.J. Dillon and my friend Mark. And it's all in. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a picture of the whole thing, and I'll show it to you because I'm gonna bring a camera where I can show you the picture of it.
Will you make sure you look me up? Did you and I take one together?
Yeah, we took one. I think it was that Sunday, because do you remember when you went to the me and my friend Mark was sitting there in the lobby, and you said, "Can you watch my stuff for me?" And I said, "Sure." And me and my friend Mark was sitting there, and you had went to the bar, and I think got some ice because you were drinking a beer, and you were I think you were talking to, what's his name, Skandor Akbar?
He's my old buddy. He'll be there this year.
Yeah, he's going to be there this year.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Well, I've got a beer sitting in front of me, but I haven't been able to touch it in an hour and a half. Probably warm as the room is, but I'm a good beer drinker, that's for sure. And I was probably a little chubby. I'm going to be a little trimmer this year, I promise you that.
Do you still work at Domino's Pizza in Charlotte?
No, and I really wish you wouldn't have brought that up over the phone. I mean,
sorry.
You know, I kid people about this. You know, people are honored to speak to me, and it's such a. And I think, my God, I'm their hero, and they don't even know I deliver pizzas. And I did. I did it for 6 years, and I don't do it anymore. They canned me. Because they the minimum wage went up, and they wanted the drivers to make pizzas. And I said, sorry, guys, I'm not making pizzas. I'm getting too old anyway to be doing two jobs. You need somebody younger. Maybe it's better we part our ways. But I'll say it right on the phone to anybody out there that's listening that Tommy Young has delivered pizzas. And that is the truth. I'm not going to deny it. I'm an honest guy. And, you know, wrestling is over for me. It's been over for a long time. And you have to go on to something else. I mean, you can't go into a shell and just, you know, stop existing. You still have to have some kind of an income. And I took the Domino's job just to supplement my income. And, the, you know, it was good extra money, but I don't have that anymore. I just have one job now where I drive a parts truck for a local Toyota dealership. And a lot of people know me from the deliveries, you know, that I make, where they've seen me. Because one thing I had was a lot of TV time. I mean, good grief, my mug was everywhere. Mm-hmm. And I was on the Superstation, you know, before cable was even cool. And I had I have a couple of twin brothers. I'm not a twin. They're twins, but they were in the military back in the late 70s, and they were over on the island of Guam, and they saw me in Guam. That's when the cable was just starting to get strong. So I've been on all over the world, and I've delivered pizzas. I mean, that's going, what's that about what goes around comes around?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Got to make a living.
That's right.
Well, the Domino's job was extra money. I mean, it rotated around my main job, which was a parts truck driver for a Toyota dealership. You see, before I got into wrestling, I drove a truck in Detroit. And back when I got into wrestling and was in it from 75 through 89 when I got hurt and I had to quit, a lot of it was driving. There wasn't much flying because back then it was totally different. Now it's almost all flying. There's some driving, but not like it once was. But it was a lot of driving. And then when I went back to my parts truck driving, I'm a truck driver and a Domino's delivery driver, you're driving. So my whole life has been, my whole adult life has been mostly been behind the wheel of some vehicle.
Yeah. Now, you know, actually, Incher, he drives in from West Virginia, and the one time I took the drive with him, did you ever drive through there? Because we've talked to some of the guys at the Fan Fest, and they've always said that's like some dangerous places to drive through.
You say West Virginia?
Yeah, that's where One Inch Biceps here is from.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I occasionally refereed in Charleston. That was a regular stop. They had a very nice building there, as they still do. Huntington, which is only about 30.
That's where I'm at.
Okay, well, that's only about 30, 40 miles down the road from Charleston.
Mm-hmm.
I refereed there often. There was a town way up in the mountains. I'm trying to remember it. Near Charleston, doggone it, I think it was Logan.
Okay.
Logan,
yeah.
Does that ring a bell?
Yeah, Logan.
This was something. I mean, the curves were so tight, you could see the hind end of your car going around them. I mean, you go up in those mountains over, but we finally got there, and the place was packed, and I think it was Flair and Steamboat. They had a super match like they never did, right? And I refereed in Beckley, refereed in Bluefield. I was all over West Virginia, but I didn't think it was particularly dangerous. The roads could be kind of a little tough, but the interstates were good. You got, you know, 77 and 64.
Mm-hmm.
And Logan, like I say, was a tough drive. But that wasn't that far from Charleston, and we were staying over. I think we did Charleston Friday, and then we had Logan the next day, and then we went home from Logan. But I was in and out of West Virginia a lot. I think there was a town called Fairmont, West Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
It was like 400 miles from Charlotte, a long way. You drove up, did it, and came back that night. That was tough. But, yeah, I was in West Virginia a lot, but I never found it all that difficult.
Mm-hmm.
The fans were they were cool. Mountain folks, they can get a little wild, but I loved it. everything was great. No problem. I loved West Virginia, and I'll be going through there shortly when I'm heading for Michigan in a few days.
Oh, that's cool. Do you ever get wild up there in the mountains?
No, you better believe it.
Thanks for calling in, Carol.
No, one more thing.
I just wanted
to say that I do appreciate everything you've ever done in professional wrestling, being a referee. I hated the times you got knocked out sometimes when it got real rough, you know, but I just wanted to say that I appreciate everything you've ever done in professional wrestling. I appreciate the name tag that you gave me in 2007, and I can't wait to look to be up there again this year in 2010, and I can't wait to look you up there.
Well, make sure you see me, because I'll be parading around, talking to everybody I can, and I'll be hanging around. But I mean, I am a goodwill ambassador. I don't play the role. I mean, without the fans, we're nothing. I mean, and I've always felt that way. I'm doing the question and answer thing Thursday. I'm going to be doing photo ops, I think, on Friday. There will be the banquet Friday night. There will be matches Saturday and matches Sunday. I don't know if I'm doing matches Sunday, but I probably am. So I should be there all 4 days. So you'll be so sick of me, you'll want to be hiding.
Oh, it'll be cool because I'm coming up there Thursday. I'm leaving Thursday morning to be up there. Well, I've already got my reservations and everything, and I'm coming up there.
Right.
I can't wait.
I appreciate it. And you make sure you say hello to me.
Oh, don't worry, I will.
All right, I appreciate it.
See you, Carol.
Me too. All right.
Bye-bye.
See you next week.
Carol. Okay, Carol, you take care. Be safe.
Yeah. You know, speaking of the Hall of Heroes, we didn't mention that yet. The Hall of Heroes dinner banquet's always one of the highlights of the weekend. Do you enjoy being part of that?
Well, I'd enjoy it more if they'd give me an award. I mean, I did it the 1 year I went up there and introduced George Scott,
mm-hmm.
my old boss, who was the booker all through the 70s. And you talk about a guy that really was legendary in professional wrestling. I mean, he was the one that created Ric Flair. Ric Flair wanted to be a cowboy.
Mm-hmm.
And George talked him into being the Nature Boy. Because George was great friends with Buddy Rogers, the original Nature Boy, and they talked about it, and they thought that Rick would be great for that. Buddy was in here in the late 70s, 79. It was a real honor working with him, and I even roomed with him one night in Richmond. So that was a real honor.
Yeah.
So, George Scott did so many things. He was... He also had a big hand in creating the WrestleManias because he was working for McMahon. George Scott gave Steamboat the big push. I mean, I could go on with George Scott. I mean, he's the one that gave Tommy Young the opportunity because, you see, I was with a group called the IWA in 75. And when they disbanded, I tried to come here, and the big boss, Jim Crockett, did not want me. I was the enemy. Because I had been opposition. Well, I didn't even know what opposition was. This was an opportunity. And George told me, he said, hey, I run the show here. I'm going to use you. He hired me, and the rest is history. I still stay in touch with the man. I just talked to him yesterday. And anyway, I nominated him for the awards, and I am very much looking forward to the banquet.
Mm-hmm. This evening we inducted Joe Blanchard, Mr. Wrestling 2, Reggie Parks, who makes all the titles, Billy Robinson, Greg the Hammer Valentine, his father Johnny Valentine, Mr. Wrestling Tim Woods, and our guest for next week, Danny Hodge.
You know, I never knew Danny Hodge. I always wanted to meet him. I heard he had a grip that could bring King Kong to his knees. I heard that man was incredibly strong and mm-hmm. one tough dude. I don't think Danny even knows who I am. But he has quite a reputation, and I've always wanted to meet him, and hopefully I will someday.
Yeah, he's going to be there. Yeah, I've always heard stories that he could break pliers with his hands and
I heard that.
Squeeze apples. And I know when he takes the pictures with the fans, like obviously he doesn't hurt them, but he puts them in some holds, and they can feel a little bit.
Is he going to be at FanFest?
Yeah, he's
going
to be at FanFest.
Okay, then I'll get a chance to meet him.
Yeah.
Now you understand why I want to be there. I mean, I'll tell you the truth. I called the promoter Greg Price and I begged him. I said, Greg, I want to be there. I mean, mm-hmm. I want to be there. I mean, I hope you got room for me. You don't have to fly me. I'm already here.
Mm-hmm.
A friend of mine, Pat Buckley, is coming down to visit me. All the guys know him, and I'll be going over there each day. And Pat doesn't drink, so I can get hammered in the bar, and he'll get me home. And that'll be good, so I don't have to worry about getting arrested and get thrown in jail and not being able to make it the other day. So I've got everything covered, I think.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you collect anything? Do you have any type of collection from the wrestling business?
You know, I have a little bit, but very little. I never really took myself that seriously. And the Crocketts would give me tapes from the Starcade shows, and I'd give them away to people. And I wish to God I hadn't done that.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm glad the people got satisfaction with that, but I'd like to have some of those tapes, and I don't have a lot of them anymore. I have a few things, but I really don't have that many. I'm collecting more stuff now, but I've been gone 20 years. Mm. So I did not collect like I should have. And I'll tell you another thing that I was guilty about, and I feel bad about this, is that I never used to answer fan mail. I didn't get much fan mail, but the little bit that I did, I remember this one boy, he was a diabetic, and he wrote me a nice letter. And, God, I wish to God I could meet that kid and tell him I'm sorry, and I really wish I had answered. You know, I just did not take myself seriously enough. You know, we all have regrets. I know I do. Like I said, I didn't get much mail, but the mail that I did, I really didn't pay much attention to it. But I will tell you this. I did an interview. I think it was Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling Gateway, it was called.
Yeah, Mid-Atlantic Gateway.
Yes, and I got letters from all over the world. I got one from Holland, one from Thailand. And I didn't have a computer. I just recently got one. I don't know how to use it yet, but I'm going to learn. But everybody that put their phone number on the email, because the gentleman that did the interview, Dick Bourne, a good friend, he will be there.
Mm-hmm.
He collected all the emails and sent them to me. And every single one of those fans that put their phone number on the email, I called them. And it was funny as hell. I'm calling people, and, honey, it's Tommy Young. It's who? It's Tommy Young. It's who? It's Tommy Young. Tommy Young? He says he's Tommy Young. Hello? Is this Tommy Young? I said, yeah, whoever it was. How you doing, Joe? It's good to talk to you. I just wanted to call you and thank you for the very nice email. I mean, people were flipping out. And I thought, hey, I'm just a person like you. You put your phone number on there. And they were very nice emails. I've kept them. I mean, they will always be with me. And I called every single person that put their phone number on it. I mean, you know, people were stunned. And you know me, I'm long-winded. We've been talking almost 2 hours, and I'm just getting going. So, you know, I told Greg, I said, when it comes to the fans and anybody that's nice enough to remember me and want to talk to me and say nice things to me or insult me, whatever the hell they want to do, that's okay. I love it. I love to intermingle with the people. I don't cop an attitude when I come in the fan fest. And will you guys be at the fan fest?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Barbie sure. Won't be from England, but Inch and I will be there.
Oh well, shucks, brother. I'm sorry you won't be there, but I mean, you know, if I walk by and I don't notice you or act stuck up, you know, knock me down and put the figure four grapevine on me, do something to keep me there, and we'll talk, you won't get away from me. I'll yap all night. I'm like that. I mean, I, you know, the people were everything to me, and, you know, the fact that you guys wanted to talk to me means a lot to me, because I've been gone 20 years, and let's face it, I was a referee. I mean, you know, a referee's not a wrestler. I mean, Tommy Young... 10,000 Tommy Youngs don't make a half a Ric Flair. So I'm very appreciative of the fact that the people are so nice to me. And you know, different buildings, you know, I got weird reactions. And I mean, Philadelphia was really funny. I mean, I'd go I forget where it was. It wasn't the Spectrum. I think it was the Civic Center. And the audience there was really strange. The one side of the building loved me. And the other side hated me. It was the craziest thing you ever saw. I always heard that, you know, the old Boston Garden. You're calling from Boston, right?
Massachusetts. I'm actually in
Cape
Cod.
The old Boston, Garden.
I've been there.
Okay, I always wanted to work. They've closed it, right? It's not there. It might be there, but they don't go there anymore, right?
Yeah, they opened a new one, and it's, I forget what it's called. It's something different now. Like
I had heard stories. The Boston Garden fans were so rowdy that they had to put something over the ring to protect everybody from all the bottles and everything that they threw. None of that was true. The fans there were great. I loved it. Marvin Hagler, former middleweight champion, he was sitting right in the front row. I loved it. I loved going to all the places I thank Almighty God for the opportunity to do what I did, for giving me the ability and the opportunity to do it. God only knows how many guys out there that were way better than me and never got their chance at it. So I'm very grateful for that, and I love to talk to the fans, intermingle with them, I'm always there for them. I will not cop an attitude. I will never do that.
You know, you mentioned Charles Robinson a couple times, and we've met him at the Fan Fest a couple times. He just comes, you know, as a fan, and walks around and talks to people, and then buys stuff, takes some pictures. So you never know who not just the people that they list on the website. You never know who's going to be at the Fan Fest.
Well, you know, Robbie always comes down, and it was funny. The about a year ago, Ric Flair's boy Reed Flair, mm-hmm. who was starting to wrestle now, he was amateur wrestling at one of the high schools, and Robbie and I were both friendly with Rick, and I'm an old family friend of the Flair's. Rick's daughter Ashley just got married. I attended her wedding just about a month ago, but Reed had wrestled, and Robbie and I were talking to him. And I said, you know, this is really kind of ironic because we are looking at the past in Tommy Young, the present in Charles Robinson, and the future in Reed Flair. And I mentioned that. I said, you know, this is a unique moment, the three of us standing here. It's the past, the present, and the future. And how well Reed does, I do not know. I hope he does very well. He's a good kid. He's a family friend. I've known him ever since he was a little toddler, and boy, he was always a hellion. I mean, Rick told me one time he woke up and Reed was coming off the top of the bed with a Jimmy Snuka dive on him, and he was only like 2 years old. I mean, this kid is wild. So Robbie comes down all the time, and he's never been. I don't think they can use him because Robbie's got a contract with Vince. That's a touchy thing. He's got to be careful.
Yeah.
But he can come down and see the guys, and he doesn't cop an attitude like, hey, I'm Charles Robinson. I'm the man in WWE. He doesn't do that. He's just another guy. He doesn't play the role. He's good people. I can never find him because he's always on the road. And he's staying busy. He has a beautiful daughter. And I guarantee you he will be there, and he will not cop an attitude either. He's a great guy. I'm looking forward to seeing him.
Mm-hmm. Entry, do you have a question?
Yeah, I do, from the blue guy. He wants to know if you have any memories on the cage catching on fire at Halloween Havoc.
No! wait a minute, the blue guy? Who's
yeah.
the blue guy? That's the blue demon?
No, that's who typed in the question to us.
You know, that was funny as hell. I'm glad you asked me that. I appreciate that. That particular night, we were supposed to have an electrified cage, and we had burlap sacks up at the top of it for effect. Now, that show... I was not doing that match. We had a special referee, the legendary Bruno Sammartino. And I thought, oh, right on. I get to get out of here and beat the crowd. I can never do that. I was always doing the main event. Tommy, would you mind sticking around just in case we might need you? And I thought, well, hell, I don't mind being Bruno's deputy. That's cool by me. So I thought, yeah, I'll stick around. I left my stripes on and everything. At least I think I had them. Yeah, I had them on. Well, anyway, they were, as I recall, it was Sting and, come on, Tommy. It was Muda and Funk against Flair and Sting. That's right. And Bruno was the referee. And they were lowering the cage to get ready for it. And then they electrified it. Trouble was, when they did that, the burlap sacks caught fire. And I'm looking at it and I'm thinking, hey, this is great, man. We've even got a fire. I thought it was part of the show. Well, anyway, I'm up on the stage, and next thing I know, here goes one of the TBS guys charging down to the ring with a fire extinguisher. And I thought, whoops, something ain't good here. Trouble was, when he got there, there was nothing in the fire extinguisher. It didn't work. So I came down to the ring by then, and I climbed up the cage at the burlap sack, which was on fire, and I'm thinking, well, what the hell are you doing? What are you going to do now? and you know, so I thought, well, I started beating on the sack with my hand, trying to put the fire out, and the sack is breaking apart, and sparks are going into the audience. And one burned this girl's dress. The audience is loving it. They're putting me over. Hey, Tommy, right on. And I must look like a complete idiot. They had it on tape, and I'm banging the fire away with my hand and burning my hand. Somebody else tried to help me, too. But you know who saved the day was Muda. Muda got I think it was food coloring that he would spit.
Mm-hmm.
He blew a bunch of the food coloring onto the burlap sack, and that helped put the fire out. I got it out a little bit, but Muda completely got it out. It was the funniest thing you ever seen. I thought, you know, the audience is they're putting me over, but I thought, you must look really stupid. I mean, you're up here, and what are you going to do? I mean, I thought, what do I do now? So I'm banging on this. We got away with it, and because of what happened, the fire marshal says, look, no electricity or no match. So the audience understood. The audience understood that we could not have the cage electrified because of the danger of the fire. So they went ahead and had the match. Everything was okay. But this was the funniest thing you ever seen. It was like poor Owen Hart, bless his heart, when he fell out of the harness into the ring,
mm-hmm.
when he died. A lot of people thought that was part of the show.
Yeah.
And I thought that the burlap sacks were supposed to catch fire. I didn't know what the hell was going on. And the things are burning. There were several of them. And I burned my hand a little bit. I was lucky I didn't get any fire in my face because it was bouncing off my clothes. But it didn't burn me. But I do remember one girl, her dress got burned, but she was laughing like hell. She thought it was great, too. So it was just one of those things that happened that I really wasn't involved in, but I wound up getting involved in. Crazy, huh?
I'm going to take one more call. Here we got Joel calling in from Portugal.
Hello there.
Portugal, my God.
Yes. And I'm not related to Aldo Montoya, unfortunately.
What part of Portugal? Lisbon?
In the north part of Portugal.
Okay, I'm honored to get a call from Portugal. What can I do for you, my friend?
I have two quick questions to ask you. As a casual fan, I've noticed a couple of times that referees sometimes have close calls with wrestlers, for instance, you know, almost bumping into them when they're running the ropes, and they have to quickly, you know, step out of the way. Have there been any time where that has happened to you, for instance? In the spot
where I got run over?
Yeah, for instance.
Well, one time we were in a town called, we were in Albany, Georgia, which is in the States here, and the Road Warriors were in the ring. I forget who they were wrestling, but somebody did something that aggravated Animal, the thicker one, the shorter one, always had the spider on his head. And anyway, I said, now, cool it, Animal. Well, he ran right over me. I mean, I went down, and he stepped across my crotch, my chest, and my head. I mean, he just ran right over me, and I'm laying there stunned. I mean this guy's 300 pounds, and he's built like a brick shit house.
Right.
And brother, it was just one of those things. Now, when they ran the ropes, I would usually just, all you have to do there is just simply step into the corner, unless of course there was a situation where I was supposed to get run into. But in the situation with Animal, like I just said, I had no idea that was coming. And like I said, he immediately was sorry he did it. He just got so worked up, and he went at the guy, and I got under him, and he just stepped right over me, and it happened. But as far as running the ropes, you know, sometimes I got in the way because my style was to referee very close. I had a close style. And sometimes I'd catch an elbow in the nose. I remember one time Arn Anderson, I got too close, and he drew back to hit a guy, and wham, right in the nose, broke my nose. And he come back to me apologizing in the dressing room. Sorry, Tom Stenna. I said, hey, brother, it's a rough business. You get knocked around sometimes. I shouldn't have been in your way. It's, you know, you didn't mean that. I used to come home at times and take my clothes off, and I'd have bruises on me that I didn't have earlier that occurred. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not trying to say that what I did even compared to what the wrestlers did. But I got banged around a lot more than most referees, and unfortunately, I got banged once too much, and it caused my neck to get broken, and goodbye career. But I had 15 great years. Should have been longer, but you know, sometimes things happen. But I hope that answers your question appropriately.
Yeah, it does, yes. I have a second follow-up question. What do you think of referees sometimes being involved in certain matches, for instance, being involved in spots in matches where they bump or they have like the screw job type of worked screw job type of spots? Do you think that referees should have a more neutral role in wrestling matches? Like in Japan, they're just there to referee and nothing else. So what's your thought about
it? Well, you know, when you do things like that, it opens doors to so many other things that you can do. Now, I'm glad that you told me about the Japanese referees, because I've never been to Japan. And I, you know, that opportunity came along after I got hurt. Nick Patrick told me about refereeing, and I think it's the Egg Dome, something like 50,000 people in there.
Tokyo Dome, yes. Egg Dome or Tokyo Dome.
Nick's an old friend of mine, and, you know, I didn't get the opportunity to do that because I got hurt before we were really going overseas. Now they go overseas all the time. And, you know, when you do things like that, and I did that a lot during my career, I got bumped probably more than just about any referee that ever was, or certainly one of them, but that opens doors. I mean, you know, the whole concept of it was that, you know, the baby face, the good guy, he can't get beat legitimately. If he gets beat legitimately, the people are not going to have much faith in him. They're going to say, well, you know, he's not that good. So you do something where the referee maybe gets knocked down and something happens, and, well, the good guy would have won, but the idiot referee didn't get out of the way, and, you know, he didn't lose because the guy beat him. He lost because the referee screwed up. So that's the reason that's done. I'm sure you realize that anyway. I'm not aware of – I thought that referees in Japan were like the ones here. But I don't know, because I never get to see any Japanese matches.
With few exceptions, it's pretty much the referees are just there to just, you know, call them, hey, get back in the ring, or, you know, like that. But they very seldomly take bumps or, you know, get directly involved in the match.
Well, whatever the reason for it, it's successful, because the Japanese are very high in their wrestling. And it does very well over there. So that style is obviously not necessary there. But in America, at least back when I was in it, it seems to be less going on now than, you know, we were talking about that earlier tonight, where you don't see that much referees getting bumped every that often. It happens occasionally, but not that much. Me, I was getting bumped at least a couple times a week. Sometimes we'd work spots in there that really weren't even involved in the match, just to throw people off, think, oh, something's going to happen. But it was just a spot we did, and I'd recover and finish the match. The spot didn't have anything to do with the finish. You know, keep the people guessing. This was the whole idea. But the basic concept of wrestling was the referee had to be blind as a bat. Because, you know, the good guy has to have a reason for getting beat, if he's getting beat, and, you know, to prolong things and, of course, draw as much money as they could, because the bottom line is always the buck. That's what it's all about. So if the Japanese referees aren't doing it, well, maybe they just don't need to do it, and I say right on. But in my case, it happened a lot. That's the way the business was designed. If it's designed that much anymore, I don't know, because I never watched the pay-per-views. Maybe they're doing more bumping than that. I don't know. But when I was around, boy, there was a lot of bumping. I was bouncing around like a yo-yo.
What would you do in a match if it wasn't the play and finish and the guy didn't kick out when he was supposed to?
Well, that, you know, the office would tell me, hey, you know, Gene Anderson, I talked about him earlier. He was the assistant booker. And Gene would tell me, and he'd tell the guys, hey, get those shoulders up. If their shoulders are down, count them out. If they don't break on four, because the magic number for counting, you know, to break was five. Mm-hmm. If they don't break before I get to five, disqualify them. The count out, it was 10. If they're not in the ring by 10, you know, count them out. Now, some guys were constantly screwing up. And, you know, you try to avoid that because, you know, you can also make an enemy out of a wrestler,
yeah.
You know. But there were ways around that. One time we were in Norfolk, and I think it was Steamboat, was wrestling Greg Valentine. Well, Greg would get lazy, and he got a guy in the ropes. He got Steamboat in the ropes, and he just would not break. And, come on, Valentine, breaking up. Because I wouldn't start the count right away. You want to let him get some heat up. And then you use the count as a last resort. So I went 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm getting louder and louder. And I get to 4, and he's just not paying any attention. So I went 5, hit the bell. And the timekeeper hits the bell. And Greg goes, whoa, whoa, that's not the finish. I said, well, you just made it the finish, pal. But so he's, oh, no, you know, we didn't do what we were supposed to, and everybody's going to get in trouble. But as I'm going to the timekeeper, I whispered to Steamboat, don't accept it. So I tell the ring announcer, Valentine has been disqualified. The winner is Ricky Steamboat. I yank his arm up, and he yanks it down. No, no, you're the winner. No, I don't want it this way. I don't want it this way. And then he starts appealing to the people. And then the people, let it go, let it go. And I'm looking around frustrated. Ring the bell. Continue the match. And you get out of it that way. And there were some guys. We had a guy, a good kid named Lynn Denton. I don't know if you remember him.
Yeah.
He got lazy in Asheville.
He's a grappler?
Could be. I don't know. I think he became the grappler. Could have been. Lynn was a very good talent. I haven't seen him in many, many years. But he was a Texas kid. Funny guy. Loved him. And a very good performer. And we were in Asheville, North Carolina, in the mountains. And Gene was there that day. And it wasn't the main event. It was a prelim. But he was lazy with his shoulders. And went 1, 2, 3. And I counted them out. And he come up, man, what the fuck? Oh, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that. I'm sorry.
That's all right. It's okay.
What the bleep you doing, you know? And I said, hey, Lynn, you got to get those shoulders up. My shoulders were up. He's giving me hell. We went back in the dressing room, he's griping, because he knows he's going to get hell from the booker for, you know. And anyway, Gene Anderson said, hey, kid, you didn't get him up. And Lynn shut right up because he knew he was wrong. He was trying to, you know, cover his ass, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
So every once in a while that would happen, but you covered for them. I mean, because you did your best to, you know, because it changes everything around. And like I said, you know, guys will think, well, he could have done something else, and you can make an enemy that way. And these are guys you got to work with, and you know, you don't want them remembering that. And there might be a situation where they're going to bop you. I mean, one time Greg Valentine hit me so hard, I saw stars. And I went down on it, and I saw him kind of half-assed grin. It was a deal where he was caught in a sleeper. And instead of, you know, wanting to give up, he belts me, and I disqualify him.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew Greg deliberately hit me hard. And when I came back from the dressing room, I just walked up to him and flipped him the bird, like, thanks a lot, that was real cool. Well, he knew he had it coming, so he gave me some slack on that. But I had a few ups and downs with Greg. But overall, Greg's a good guy. You know, no problem there. But you want to keep as good a camaraderie with these guys as you can, because 95% of them can hit me so hard they could knock me halfway to the moon.
Right.
And I have to think about that. You know, and it's a fine line that you walk. I did not have many enemies in wrestling at all, if I had any. There were some guys that I didn't care for. Some guys didn't care for me. But generally speaking, I had a good camaraderie with most of them, almost all of them. There were very few exceptions, and the ones that there were, usually I made peace with them later.
Mm-hmm.
One guy that was very difficult to me for a while was Kevin Sullivan, and I made my peace with Kevin later, but he was one guy you never wanted mad at you, because Kevin is as mean as the day is long. I mean, Kevin is willing to do the things to me that I'm not willing to do to him, so I would never fight him.
Yeah.
So, but I made my peace with Kevin, and he's a good guy. But, you know, so many things come to mind. I'm sorry.
No, that's all right. Well, was there any reason why he didn't like you?
I don't know why, but I had difficulty with him. We were in a spot show one night. It was somewhere in Ohio. I forget where it was. But we were doing TV. You didn't want to screw TV up if you could absolutely avoid it. And he was working a tag match, and he just came in without even tagging and did the finish. And it made me look like an idiot. And I the next night I said, "Kevin, can I speak to you?" And he said, I saw him glare at me, and then he, "What is it?" And I said, "I just want you to know I want to work with you as best I can, and I want to be as good a referee as I can for you. But last night you buried me, and it made it very difficult for me." And he blew his stack, says, "We were doing TV, time was running out, blah, blah, blah." And then he grabbed me by the front of my sweater. I was in my street clothes, and dragged me into the dressing room. And all the guys are sitting there looking at him. Steve Williams, Dr. Death, the Steiner brothers, the Road Warriors, and Kevin wasn't popular with some of these guys. And I noticed they were all glaring at him like, you know, "What are you doing to Tommy?" And he dragged me over to Paul Jones, who was the agent that night, and says, "Tell him your problem." And I said, "Hey, man, I just want to get along. I'm sorry I upset you. I won't bother you again." And I went to the ring and reffed. Well, Rick Steiner, who did not like Kevin, picked a fight with him that night, and kind of roughed him up. I don't know if it was because of me, but Kevin was, you know, I was scared of Kevin. Kevin was a, you know, just a really scary guy, because he'd do anything. He'd rip your eye right out. Ronnie Garvin was like that. I got along great with Ronnie, but I made sure I did. I mean, if Ronnie Garvin fought Kevin Sullivan, somebody would be dead. I mean, those were two guys that, you know, that everybody were very leery of, because they were triple tough guys and they'd do anything. A lot of people have limitations as to what they'll do. If I'm fighting you, I'm not going to try to rip your eye out.
Right.
So, you know, and if there's a guy that's willing to do that to you, you don't want to fight him, because you're not willing to do to him what he's willing to do to you.
Mm-hmm.
So you're better off. But later on, I went to a thing called Slamboree in 1992.
Yeah, and, Legends Reunion. Yeah,
I'm sorry.
That was a legend. You go on.
And Kevin's children were there, and I said, "You know, Kevin, your son has really turned into a good-looking young man." He said, "Thank you, Tommy." He said, "Can I talk to you?" And I said, "Sure." He said, "You know, I never apologized to you for what I did to you that night, and I feel I owe that to you, and I just want you to know I shouldn't have done that, and I'm sorry." And that was very nice of him. He didn't have to do that, and I appreciated that. And we've been cool ever since. He was a vendor a couple of years ago at one of the fan fests here,
yeah.
And I had a nice talk with him. And he's a good guy. I like him.
Yeah, we actually interviewed him that year at the fan fest.
Mm-hmm.
It was pretty cool. And
yeah.
We talked about it because he's from Boston.
Well, you know, it's yes, he is, and it's. I had some difficulty, you know, with the guy that, who was the guy, the Canadian guy that killed everybody.
Benoit.
You know, it seemed like everybody liked this guy, and yet I was always leery of him. He was never friendly to me. He never spoke. He just looked at me. There was something about him that always bothered me.
Mm-hmm.
And I was never comfortable around him. And, the woman that he killed, Nancy,
mm-hmm.
she used to be with Kevin.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved Nancy to death. I mean, she was a good friend.
And that broke my heart that she died that way. She didn't deserve that. You know, he's dead. They're all dead. So rest in peace. But I bring that up because I remember Nancy when Kevin was with her, and she was a hell of a lady. I don't know what happened with Benoit. That was as horrible as it gets.
Yeah. I mean, we never was around him, but my mom always thought there was something wrong with him whenever she just saw him on TV. Then you know, when it happened, she just said she always she just thought there was just something not right about the guy. Just by the way he looked on TV, like his eyes and everything.
Now, who said this?
My mother.
Okay, well, tell your mom she and I kind of agree on that one.
Yeah.
but everybody seemed to like him. He mm-hmm. was tight with Flair. My old buddy Dean Malenko, he was tight with Dean. I'd always come up and, hi, Dean, how you doing? He'd be there, and he'd just look at me. He wouldn't say hello. He'd just always stare at me. And he gave me the creeps.
Yeah.
There was something about him that bothered me. Kevin introduced me to him when Kevin and him were having those restroom matches.
Oh, yeah. That was crazy.
Those were stiff, and I think they were especially stiff because at the time, I think Benoit was taking Nancy away from Kevin.
Yeah.
So
I think that's how that how that started. Like, they did that outside of the ring to try to get it over with people, and then it became like a reality.
It could have. I really don't know because I was gone by then.
Yeah.
And but I mean, you could tell that was rough. I mean, if Kevin was going to hit you with a chair, brother, you better put your arms up because Kevin would make that chair part of you.
Mm-hmm.
That's just the way he did things. And it was wild what happened between them. But, you know, memories.
Mm-hmm.
Not all of them are good.
Yeah. Well, anyway, thanks for calling in, Joel.
Is he there?
Yeah, I think he left. But
okay, but yeah, good talking to you, my friend. I've missed you, but I appreciate you calling in, too.
Yeah. Let everybody know again, August 5th through the 8th, Charlotte, North Carolina, NWALegends.com. Get all your ticket information for the NWA Legends Fan Fest. And, you know, the hotel itself is really nice, and right outside of it, you got the lake, and you got all the little restaurants, so it's a really good time.
Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping, you know, Ole is supposed to be there. And if you've been there, you know that Ole always holds court.
Oh, yeah.
He's always right in the lobby, and he's always got a crowd because he's got so many stories. His health is giving him some difficulty. You know, he may not be there. I hope he is,
mm-hmm.
because that's a part of it. He's always holding court, and it's fascinating just to listen to him. He's having a lot of health issues with that multiple sclerosis.
Yeah, yeah. I heard he might actually not be able to attend this year.
It may happen. A good friend of mine, Peggy Lathan, she stays in touch with him, and I think he's going to try to make it. He wants mm-hmm. to be there, but it really boils down to his health. I hope he makes it. He's definitely part of it, a big part.
Yeah. You know, a lot of people always said, like, he's not a nice guy, but like you said, every year at the Fan Fest, he sits in the lobby, talks to all the fans, and he's like one of the most approachable guys.
Yeah, I had some difficulty with him during my career because he got his jollies picking on people.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, later on I kind of made my peace with him too. But he could be brutal. But I'm telling you, in the ring, him and Gene, what a team. I saw tons of teams. I never saw a team work any better than them. I mean, Midnighters were great, but Midnighters had Corny. I mean, the Andersons, it was just them. They didn't have any manager. They didn't need one. And they were so believable in the way they did things. I have nothing but total respect for them.
Mm-hmm.
To me, the Anderson brothers were the greatest tag team I ever refereed.
What match was it in where you had your career-ending injury?
Well, you know, you can see it on YouTube.
Yeah.
All you got to do is look up Tommy Young. It's on there. Why it's on there, I'll never know. But it is. I remember it like it was yesterday. Mike Rotunda, an old friend, who I just saw the other night when Steamboat was in the ring. I don't know if you saw that.
Oh yeah,
it was great to see Mike. He was he's looking good. Mike was at the time he was called Michael Wall Street. Before that, he was IRS with Vince.
Yeah.
But he was Michael Wall Street, and he was wrestling the infamous Tommy Rich.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, this particular match, this was only a spot we were doing. This was not even the finish. You know, over the top rope was automatic DQ. So I've talked about this before. I'll tell it again for your benefit and for who's ever out there listening. It was supposed to be a deal where Tommy's got Mike in the ropes, pounding him. Tommy's the babyface. We were doing TV. This was right on TV, and Jim Ross, when he was still Jim Ross, was doing the commentary. It was, I'll never forget the night. It was the last night of Tommy Young's career, November the 28th, 1989. And Tommy gets Mike in the ropes and pounding on him and pounding him on. I'm trying to get him off, and I finally... do get him off, and I'm walking him backwards, lecturing him. Meanwhile, behind me, Mike is supposed to be getting to his feet. When he gets to his feet, Tommy is supposed to simply shove me in the back, keep me going the same way I'm going, you know? Like, get out of my way.
Mm-hmm.
And as he shoves me, I'm supposed to, like, fall under the ropes, just lose my balance, but not even take a bump. And meanwhile, Tommy is supposed to charge Mike, and Mike dumps him over the top rope to the floor. Well, with me falling over the ropes and taking my time turning around, Tommy's already on the floor. I don't see it, because if I see it, it's DQ. Over the top rope in the NWA to the floor was automatic DQ. So we were simply doing that spot to get that in there, that he dumped him over the top rope and I didn't see it. Well, what happened, as I was walking Tommy back, Tommy had real big feet. And somehow, you see it, he steps on my foot. And as he's walking, you know, I'm walking him backwards, so the ropes are pretty close. And when I'm walking him backwards and he gives me the shove in the back, he stepped on my foot, which, you know, he shoved me in the back, but my foot was stationary. I go flying forward, so I try to get my arms up to protect myself, you know, my face from going into the ropes. Well, it was one of those things where my arms went through the ropes, and I was falling forward and down at the same time. So I hit the middle rope right below my forehead and above my nose. You know, that little indentation between the eyes where something could, you know, you could put a pencil in there or something, you know what I'm saying? Well, I caught the rope right there, and it just snapped my neck back. And I remember hearing this god-awful cracking, like, and I remember thinking, what the hell was that? And I went down, and I remember... I was facing the audience. We had a big studio audience, 400 or 500 people. And I talked to you about Peggy Lathan, a friend of mine and a loyal fan. She's as legendary as a wrestler. She was sitting right in the front row.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember looking at her and the people, and the whole room was humming, and I felt nothing from my neck down. I felt nothing. And I remember thinking, oh, my God, you're in big trouble. And I remember thinking, I'm laying here, and I'm paralyzed, and millions of people are watching this, and nobody knows it. So they're continuing to wrestle, because when Tommy did that, he stepped in between me and Mike. So Mike did not see me hit the rope, because Tommy was between us. And Tommy didn't see it, because he's looking at Mike. He didn't even know he did it. So they continue to wrestle. And Mike covers Tommy for the finish, but I'm not there. So you see Mike kick me in the ass, like, Tommy, get over here. And I'm whispering over my shoulder, Mike, I can't move, I can't move. So he gets off of Tommy, comes over to me and rolls me over. I think he rolled me over on my back. And what's the matter? I said, I don't know. I don't feel anything. So he didn't know what to do. He just went back to Tommy and was wrestling. Now, they're catching on in the back that something's wrong, because we've got these little TV sets. They call them monitors. They're watching the matches. And what's the matter with Tommy? He isn't moving. What's the matter? And they're catching on. Something's wrong. Well, Nick Patrick and Mike Adkins, who I think is no longer with us as far as refereeing is concerned. They came to the ring, and Mike went over to the to finish the match and count Tommy out, and Nick came to me. And I said, Nick, get me away from these guys. See, he pulled me over in the apron. About that same time, Flair came out, because Flair was the booker. And he said, what is it, Tommy? I said, champ, I'm in big trouble. So I don't feel nothing. So he started pinching me, but the feeling was starting to come back, actually from my feet up, not my head down, like you would expect. Mm-hmm. And the pinches were hurting me. I said, I feel them. I'm okay. So I said, let's get out of here. They sat me up, and I jumped off the ring apron, and my legs just collapsed. They caught me. I didn't fall. But they got me back to the dressing room. And to make a long story short, I went to the hospital, had to have major league surgery where they had to go into the back like they did Arn. Arn had the same surgery I did, and Arn had to retire too.
Yeah.
Now, if they go through the front, you know, there are certain broken necks. They can go through the front. You can come back. But when they have to go through the back and remove all that vertebrae that they mm-hmm. had to remove, you're done, because that vertebrae is protecting your spine. And if I haven't shown you before, I'll show you at the Fan Fest how long the scar is. And that scar, there's no vertebrae there anymore. So that's my spine. So it's very dangerous for me to get in the ring. No, it's not very dangerous, but it's dangerous. I could get hurt. And I don't do many matches, you know, a certain ones. I'm careful, you know. But it ended, it effectively ended my career. It was just, I always knew that I would get hurt. My style dictated that. I was all over the place, and it was somewhat reckless, you know, the slides and the dives, and sometimes I'd slide all the way to the floor and bang my hip on the floor, and my hip's been giving me trouble ever since, but it was a good move, and sometimes I would do it. It happened just one night. I wore those polyester pants and slid right out of the ring to the floor. I thought, well, we'll do this every so often. So once in a while, we do it. They get a false finish, and I'd slide. I'd be out on the floor, and I'm not there. You know, it's another spot you can do. But anyway, that was it. It was goodbye career. Tommy didn't mean to do it, but Tommy was careless, and it cost me my career. And that's the breaks, I'm afraid.
When your referee career was over, did you want to stay like in the wrestling business, like either you know something behind the scenes, or did you just want to get out of it?
Yeah, I did. Back then, the guy that was running things was a man named Jim Hurd. He was running the show, and it's funny, we talked about me delivering pizzas earlier. Jim was in the pizza business.
Yeah, right.
What he was our general manager for, I'll never know. But I approached him, and I said, you know, Jim, I was hurt on the job. You know, Magnum, bless his heart, Magnum TA, you remember when he got hurt?
Yeah.
Well, he was driving a car and just drove the car too fast, and, you know, I don't want to blame him, but, I mean, you know, it was a one-car accident. And,
right.
And
it wasn't in the ring, yeah.
Right. I'm in the ring doing my job, giving my body to a guy, and I get crippled. So I went to Jim, and I said, you know, Jim, I have a knowledge of this business. I mean, how about a job? You know, like, what do you say? And he said, well, Tommy, we'll check that out. But he said, frankly, between you and me, he said, I think you should sue. He said, we have insurance for this, and I think it would be in your best interest to sue. And I thought, wow, man, he's telling me to sue him. And I did, because they didn't give me a job. And I got a small settlement, but it was ridiculously small for what happened to me. It probably cost me somewhere in the million, neighborhood of probably $1 million in lost wages. But what do you do? I mean, you know, life goes on. I'm still grateful for the career that I had, but it was cut loose. I was only 42. And I could have done it easily another 10 years. Earl's still doing it, and he's kicking around 60. I could probably, if I had stayed healthy, I still might be doing it. I don't know. So it was very unfortunate that it happened, and I had my regrets. I had a few good cries over it, you know, because wrestling was my life. But it's a very dangerous business, and careers end every day. Normally that doesn't happen to referees.
Yeah.
But it happened to me, and that's the way it goes. There's no point being bitter about it. Tommy's going to be there this year, and that might be a little awkward for me, because I'd rather just, you know, not talk to him about it. He probably feels awkward about it too. Whether or not we will speak, I don't know. But I'm not going to initiate any contact with him. I'm not bitter towards him, although I do feel he was careless. I mean,
yeah.
You know, I gave him my body and he crippled me. I mean, he can deny it all he wants, but it's right there on the tape. And it was not deliberate. I know that. And that ended my career, and that was that. I got no job. I just got a settlement, and that was the end of it.
Now, did you ever see any type of ribs actually in the ring, like while you're refereeing a match?
Did I ever see what? I'm sorry?
Like someone play a rib on somebody, you know, in the actual match?
Yes. Yeah. I'll bring. This is not a major league rib, but it was funny. Robbie Steiner, Rick Steiner, but his name is actually Robbie Rick Steiner. That's their name. It's Rick Steiner, but
yeah.
He simply shortened it to Rick Steiner. But Robbie was always doing something goofy. And Robbie was working with Steve Williams, who just passed away recently. He's a sweetheart. I love Steve. Really great guy. And Robbie is, too. But Robbie is so damn silly and goofy. And Steve was another guy that you didn't want to mess with. I mean, he's just scary looking and a tough guy. And they were wrestling in Fayetteville, North Carolina, where the Hardy Boys are from. And I remember Robbie calling a spot, run the ropes, and Steve was supposed to drop down. And I smelled a rat right there. I thought, something's up here. And Steve dropped down, and Robbie dropped on him in an amateur stance, you know, behind the guy, you know. And the shoot was on. And Steve did everything he could. He just couldn't get away from Robbie. Steve was bigger, but Robbie was the type. You can't hurt him. You could hit him with a telephone pole, and it wouldn't even faze him.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Steve finally just got to the ropes, and I broke it up. And, you know, it was good-natured, but he was having fun with him. And Steve said to me, "You can't hurt that friggin' Steiner." And this is Steve Williams saying this. I'll give you another example, and this is a little more dramatic. We were in Sumter, South Carolina, and it was Don Kernodle and Sergeant Slaughter against Jack and Jerry Briscoe. And Flair was known for, you know, putting guys up to doing goofy stuff. And Flair told Don, "Drop down on Jerry," you know. So Don fell for it. Don can wrestle. Don was a good wrestler at Elon College. He wrestled Bob Roop and gave him one hell of a match before Bob finally beat him in a shoot match at one of our TVs. And that's how Don really kind of paid his dues and made it. But anyway, they worked the spot, and Don called for Jerry to drop down. Same thing. Don dropped down on him, you know, 2 points. Well, Jerry didn't think it was funny. And he come out of it, and he turned Don about every which way but loose. And Sarge and Jack are both on the apron looking at each other like, "What the hell's going on here?" And Don, you know, he's not trying to fight back. Don figures, well, he aggravated Jerry, let Jerry get it out of him. And we're all, and, you know, I'm looking back at Flair, and Flair is falling down laughing so hard in the corner. And, I mean, Don's getting turned every which way but loose because Flair put him up to it. And because, you know, Jerry's got a temper, and he didn't think that was funny. And, you know, later on the dressing, everything was cool. Jerry says, "I got carried away, but I'm a little funny about that stuff." And Rick knew it, but Don didn't. And Don paid the price. And Sergeant Jack, they weren't going to get in the ring and get involved in that. So, you know, Don got stretched pretty good. It was, you know, it wasn't anything all that serious, but Jerry roughed him up a little bit. Sometimes guys would, you know, play ribs, and some guys would think it was funny, and sometimes they wouldn't.
All right.
And Jerry did not think that was funny, and Don paid the price, where in case with Steve and Robbie, Steve just got to the ropes, and that was the end of it. You
mm-hmm.
know, but it was a little serious there. And then you had personality clashes sometimes. I mean, two guys that didn't like each other were Sergeant Slaughter and Blackjack Mulligan. And it was difficult with them. It was more Jack didn't like Sarge than Sarge didn't like Jack. But there was an accident where Jack got some teeth knocked out, and Jack didn't think it was all that accidental. I'm sure it was. But I got in the middle of it and got messed up there. But Jack did the job that night, just like he was supposed to. But boy, was he mad. And there was always tension between them after that. And Mulligan had such a terrible temper. Everybody was scared of Jack. I mean, Jack even, he clocked Andre one time in a hotel room.
Yeah. He has a big story about that in his book. You go on.
Well, I asked him one time, I said, Jack, why did you do that? He said, well, to tell you the truth, Tom, we were drinking, and he said, I thought, you know, if I knock this big sumbitch out, boy, what a reputation I'll have. But Andre let him get away with it. Andre just said, boss, you better get out of here before I kill you. And Jack got out of there, and that was done. But different things have happened. I could write a book. I really could, but I probably never will because so many guys already have. And, it'd just be another one, and I've been gone so long, and, it was a great career, but it got cut short sooner than it should have, but, this is Earth, not Heaven, so, what do you do?
Something I wanted to ask you about, because, you're known as the flying referee, I don't know, maybe he's a good guy or whatnot, but what do you think about Bronco Lubick?
Never knew him, but I heard that he had gotten to the point he was so old and so crippled up that he would count with his foot. Did you ever hear that? I heard he'd stand up and go 1, 2, 3 with his foot. Now, I never saw this, but I heard it.
I remember watching him as a kid, and sometimes he wouldn't even go down for the count, like if it was a near fall, and if he did go down, it would be like a one knee, and he'd kind of lean over and count 3 and.
With these poor guys that are older, I mean, so many of their bodies take a pounding, and so many of them are crippled up. I mean, one of the people that I will always respect and really love is Ivan Koloff. But Ivan Koloff worked his tail off. He bumped all the time, and poor Ivan, who I'm sure is going to be there.
Yeah, he will.
Ivan is going to be there. That poor man is so crippled up. And but he's the nicest guy, and this business takes up. It's not the UFC or anything like that, for God's sake. But the pounding that your body takes, and if you're a guy, I mean, some guys would try to get out of doing much, and other guys, there could be 20 people in the audience, and there may as well have been 20,000. That's the way they'd work.
Yeah.
It just depended on the professionalism. Ivan never took a shortcut. And there were a number of them that didn't. I mean, it depended on the individual. You hate to see that. I'm fortunate. I don't look that bad. I think the years have been kind to me. And I'm taking some weight off. I'm going to be below 200 pounds if it kills me, because I've been too porky at some of these other fan fests, and I don't want that. I'll never be 180 pounds again. In fact, one time I was as low as 166. And didn't even look too bad in a Speedo, but this was back in the mid 70s.
Yeah.
I was only in my late 20s, I couldn't maintain that. But I generally stayed about 180 pounds, and I was always very much into conditioning. And you had to be in shape to do those flare steamboat matches, because a lot of them were 1 hour matches, and they just be getting going after 25, 30 minutes. So I loved them. And like I say, memories.
Mm-hmm. Well, I want to thank you for coming on tonight. It's been a great interview.
We've been talking, 2 hours, 45 minutes?
Yeah, almost 3 hours here. I think you're catching up to the George South record.
I want to thank all the people that called in and were nice enough to say the things that they did, and everybody that's out there listening. I hope you can make it to the Fan Fest. This is really something. If you're a wrestling fan, this is well worth your while. You'll remember it forever, because there's going to be such an amount of talent there in so many different things, photo ops, the banquet dinner, wrestling matches, question and answer things. It is really one heck of a package, and I certainly encourage everybody to go, and everybody that does, please come up and talk to me, because I love to talk to you.
Yeah. It is a great time, Intra and I. We've gone the last 5 years, and pretty much all year round we talk about it, and we have a great time. If you don't want to spend a lot of money, you can just get the package, and you get the Q&As and two autographs, and You get to see everybody, yeah. And, you know, and if you want to get the photo ops, you can get that, and so much you can do. And even
do
some
you can.
Yeah, even some of the guys like Jim Cornette, the one year we were there, my brother helped pack up the car for him because he bought the whole bunch of merchandise himself.
And if everything goes well, Corny and I will be doing a question and answer session, and hopefully Terry will be doing one too because he's so great at that. I hope he is. I know I'm going to have a few drinks with my old buddy Terry. I know that. Better known as Morgan. Morgan's my buddy.
Awesome. Thanks, man.
All right, guys. And my Irish friend, it's been great talking to you, and I hope to see you down the road too, and thank you all.
All right, fans, you stay tuned to In Your Head Wrestling Radio, because if you don't, I'll hit you so hard a flock of pigeons will come out of your ass.